Good evening, everybody. Thanks so much for tuning in to this week's chat with Alex Iles. If you don't know Alex, you've heard him on literally everything you've ever heard. He's one of the most active trombone players in the film and recording industry. Also plays with a number of orchestras. Teaches at Cal Institute of the Arts, Azusa Pacific University, Cal State Northridge. And he's played with everybody, and you'll hear all about it. And before we go on, I want to thank my sponsors tonight, Euclid IQ, which is the world's leader in audio and video compression, and also Guard Bags. And this is my guard case, which I love very much. And in the guard bag, I have, of course, a Vincent Chickowitz book, which you can get at Studio 259 Productions. And also last week's episode, which I'll put up soon, is one of Tony Plogue's books, which you can get out there. They're great, great books. And so thanks again for guard bags. And also I want to mention the World Trumpet Seminar, World Trumpet Society Seminar, which is coming up this summer, which you can look up at worldtrumpetsociety.com, and you will see our really cheap and inexpensive seminar, and $25 for students and $35 for everybody else. So without any further ado, Alex, great to see you on here.
Pleasure to be here. Thanks, Mark. Thanks for inviting me.
And apparently this chat has my words coming out on the bottom. So I want to make sure that that doesn't continue to happen, because
CC.
That would be weird. Yeah, I don't know how that's going on. So I will just briefly try to correct that.
Especially if you're not saying, I imagine that would be tricky.
Well, yeah, that would be the problem. Okay, it looks like we're cool. So I'll cut this out later. So, Alex, thank you so much for coming on, and welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, and you know, before I kind of get started with your crazy, ridiculous bio and lengthy amount of things you've done, I think the first thing I want to kind of ask is, can you talk about in normal times, what your normal day is like? What's the first thing you practice? What's the first thing you do in the morning to get ready for things?
Oh, wow. That's good. It kind of depends. I mean, very often our work starts in the morning. If I'm doing recording, I might have a 10 o'clock start. And usually my driving is a big part of being a musician here. So I would usually set out on my drive probably about 7:30 to be in time to be nice and early to a 10 o'clock start. But a lot of times we don't start at 10. The brass more and more these days, even before COVID, the brass a lot of the time on recording sessions, if we were doing a big orchestra, would record at night or in the late afternoon. So that actually was kind of better for traffic. So I might not have to leave so early before the date. A lot of times we work at 6 or 7 at night. We just do our parts. Usually we have less to play than the strings and woodwinds. So very often we would just record at night. So that's been, and with COVID, that's actually been something that's happening more now that we're going back a little bit more often to record in the studio. But you know, my schedule varies day to day, week to week, month to month. I have a live music schedule with a few of the contract work that I do with the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra as the summer group, and then Long Beach Symphony I do in the winter and in through the spring, but that's not a that's about a I think altogether about a maybe 25 week 30 week commitment, and they're pretty flexible about if we have a conflict or something like that, so I try to do that as much as I can, but again, that's still not a full-time commitment. I do that because I love playing in orchestras. And I love the orchestra that I play in. It's a lot of fun. Great. And a lot of other freelance and studio musicians play in that orchestra. So that, you know, those, you know, we'll have 3 or 4 rehearsals a week and a concert with that. We have Pops concerts that are just a rehearsal the same day. Weekends are usually still pretty busy. I'm still a live freelance player a lot. So I play live things all over, and then jazz things that come up once in a while with big bands or small groups. I have my own small group that we travel a little bit here and there and do a little bit of recording. That's a group called All In that I'm in with, that's a small jazz group. And so it's a pretty big variety of music all the time. Plus the teaching, I try to fit all those things in. So, but I'd say for practicing for me, I have a routine that I kind of like to do, but I don't feel like it's necessary to do every single day as a warm up. I'm more of a long term routine person where I like to do certain important topics every day if I can, and spread them out over a period of, you know, 20 minute increments throughout a day, including all the basic things, articulation and flexibility and little long tones and all the basic sort of articulation. So all those things kind of come into play. And then if I'm preparing anything specific, I'll do that. But before, I try to always play a little bit before I go to work in the morning. If I have a 10 o'clock, I try to play for half hour, 40 minutes, just get things going at home a little bit. It's kind of obnoxious to practice too much at the studio, especially with everybody in the same room together. So I try to do as much of that at home as I can. So I get to work and we're more about hanging out before the gig more than anything. Before, there's lots of news. Usually everybody's got all the latest gossip and all the latest things that are going on, and catching up with people, especially now you haven't seen some people for a year. So a lot of catching up that goes on. So, but I definitely do have a routine that I like to follow, but it varies a lot from day to day. And I do a lot at night. I practice quite a bit at night after work. I warm down and also do other kind of musical things that I'm working on if I'm preparing for a big performance. So it's a long day sometimes, you know, between the work and practice and teaching, it can make for some pretty long days. Yeah.
What do you find is normally in that routine? I mean, are there things you constantly go to, or there's some off the beaten path kind of thing?
Well, yeah. I mean, I had a great teacher in college when I really started getting serious about playing, named Roy Main. And Roy had he was a student of Jim Stamp, and he had approached things from that perspective quite a bit. He had his own spin on it, of course, and like most teachers do, have their own thing. But he had all of his students, and that included most of the best freelance players I work with around my age group. We almost all of us studied with Roy at one point. And Roy was a great teacher and player as well. He was a freelance player. He played a lot of shows, a lot of recording sessions, played in orchestras, played jazz. He was a real great player and kind of a model player for us to look up to when we were younger. And when I studied with him, he gave me a lot of work to do, mouthpiece buzzing, like Stamp, and also a lot of sound exercises throughout all registers, working on flexibility, a lot of flexibility exercises and articulation exercises, technical things like that, a lot of Arbenz. And I still use that as kind of a foundation for a lot of my practice. The stuff I do that is maybe a little more outside that is the things I steal from everybody. I pick up things on the internet all the time now. It's amazing. I was using warm-ups by, I've been using a lot of the Chickowitz stuff and flow studies, and I love all that stuff. There's a teacher and a player and an author named Brad Edwards who's written a lot of great books for trombone, and I borrow things out of his book. I say that nicely, borrow. I rip off. He won't mind my saying that, I don't think. But I use a lot of the things from his books too, and just make a little study of, you know, low range flexibility exercises. Okay, here we go. So I'll just make something out of that. But I tend to sort of mix up those things quite a bit. I when I started studying improvisation, it changed the way I practiced everything. I use what I like to use with students, an improviser's mind, where you're constantly trying to ask questions and experiment with how would this affect this? If I don't adjust my embouchure as I go into the trigger register, what happens? How's that gonna sound? Well, it doesn't sound that great, but I still think there's something beneficial here. So you kind of get in sort of an inquisitive way of practicing that I find I've started improving more when I got that sort of inquisitive mind, rather than I'm gonna do this and I'm gonna practice this and I'm gonna move on to the next thing. And I found that was becoming more of a rote way of playing, which I was less interested in. I think everybody has to do some of that. You have to do you got to practice scales. You got to do all those kind of things. You have to practice them and have the instrument on your face for a certain amount of time. But I found that to really get inside my playing a little bit more selectively, I found that when I started thinking more about what I was doing, not to overthink, hopefully, but to think about the ultimate result and sort of always have an eye on the prize of where I want things to be going. And, you know, adapting to those ideas. I also am a big fan of David Vining, who's one of our trombone teachers, who's written some incredible books and studies on playing brass instruments in general, but also some exercises and things that I found very useful. I find his take on breathing, for instance, is one of the best I've seen. His book, The Breathing Book, is, I think, one of the best ways of describing breath in the most simple terms without any kind of... what happens, I think, with a lot of people when they start talking about breathing is it gets kind of in this area that's really going into analogy to an extent that a lot of people who aren't or a little more practical and more interested in maybe the physiology, they get a little thrown off by that way of thinking. And I'm one of those people. I question things sometimes, like, well, you know, I don't think my belly distends because that's where the air goes. That's not my take. So I like to know a little bit more about the physiology. And David's books are excellent at explaining some of those details. So anyway, but I definitely do, you know, I have a 10, 15, 20 minute routine that I do. I have an hour long routine that I do. If I've been playing a lot of certain kind of music, my routine will be not that. You know, if we're really pumping out a lot of loud bass trombone stuff at work, I'm going to come home and play my small tenor trombone and play soft, you know, just to balance those things out. So it's, for me, it's very important to have a sense of balance so that I can shift gears into doing something else tomorrow that I wasn't doing today and be ready for it. You know, we don't know what we're going to play when we go to work, unlike playing in an orchestra where you have a repertoire that you have for that year or 2 years out in front. You can take days off. You know, you can actually plan your time off, which isn't a luxury for most people like me that have to freelance. So I don't know what I'm going to have to do. So I might have to be playing some really big orchestral music one day, and then another day it's very light and maybe it's a jazz band thing. I don't know. You know, so I have to be kind of ready for any kind of those in any of those things. So in a way, that's my routine is built around that, where it's if it were one thing, it might just make me too prepared for that one thing.
Right. That's a great answer, and a lot of nice plugs to a lot of good people. I know David and Brad both very well. And
there's so many great people teaching now. It's amazing. The access to great teaching is so great now, much better than it was when I was much younger.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, before we go any further in that, I just kind of did want to go kind of over your bio a little bit. But I do see that Jerry Hayes watching, and he said, "Good guy, great player." So, you
know, my hero.
But can you talk a little bit about your start in music and in the public schools?
Yeah, I was a public school musician. Totally. I learned. I started in the fourth grade. My sister was a violinist. She's 4 years older, and she was a very good violinist. She picked it up pretty quickly, but she learned in public school too. She had private lessons. I'd go with her sometimes to private lessons, so I sort of got an idea that, hey, this is pretty interesting. I'd like to play an instrument. My parents arranged a meeting with the orchestra director at that time, a gentleman named Ken Wydaugh, who was a real innovative music educator in the 60s. And he had a meeting with each of the parents. And my mom went to the meeting at my elementary school. Sat and we'd planned out maybe a trumpet, maybe clarinet. I wasn't that committed to any one instrument at that point. So like 9 years old, I guess. And my mom went to meet with Mr. Wydaugh, and Mr. Wydaugh asked my mom, "So tell me about your son." And my mom said, "Well, he's tall." And so Mr. Wydaugh said, "Then he'll play trombone." So that was it. It was as simple as that. So when I saw my mom walking out of the meeting, I happened to be walking out with our class out to recess or something, and my mom just went like that. So that was it. I was playing trombone. So that night we went out and we got a lead on an instrument. We bought an Olds Ambassador trombone, and I came home and figured out how to go bah, bah, bah. And then the next day I was at class learning with a wonderful man who was a big influence on me named Art Farr, who was a great trumpet player, and also he was a band director in the elementary school. So he was my first band director in elementary school, and he was great, and he taught us in a group lesson. So I just, we had a few group lessons, then we're playing in the band. So then I did that all the way through. We had a really good elementary school program, we had a very good junior high program at the local schools, middle schools now, I guess, and then at our high school band was really good. We were a real good marching band at high school, and we had a very good orchestra and a really nice wind ensemble. I was always interested in jazz as a listener, but I never really saw myself playing it. But I was a big fan of jazz. I had some of the older high school students would play records, and I'd listen to them. And there were a couple people that started a Chicago style band, and I got to play in that. And then I started my own little Chicago style band in high school, and we played for dances and things like that. So that was my entry into jazz, was very roundabout, and I had a very strange entry into jazz. I was not through the music education world at all, and it was in Arcadia, which is a very, as far from a jazz world as you can get. So I didn't have access to the real musicians doing it yet. And I had to sort of learn on my own. So it was a little bit of a reverse engineering job I had to do. But I came out okay. And I by the time I got to college at UCLA, where I went to school, jazz was all around. I had a lot of there were a lot of good jazz musicians at the school and coming to play concerts. So I was suddenly I was learning a lot more about that. I didn't study music in school. I was an economics major in school. I was not sure what I wanted to do for a living, and music to me was very unlikely thing to want to do or was not practical. So I studied economics because compared to other majors, it had the fewest upper division required courses. So I figured I could get out in 4 years and I could learn about things that I was interested in besides music. I knew I loved music and I loved playing, and I was playing in every music group there was on campus. They stopped letting me take music performance classes for a grade after my sophomore year because you're only allowed to take so many. So I played in both wind ensembles, both jazz bands, the opera, the symphony orchestra, one or both wind ensembles. I was at the music building as much or more as any music major at the school because I was playing in all the groups. And we had our own groups outside. Like I mentioned, I had a brass quintet when I was at school, which included Mike Sachs, my friend, and Hero. And that was a fun little group when we played a few concerts around school and stuff. And then I was an economics major, and so I was able to explore math and writing and history and a lot of subjects that I was interested in and I kind of wanted to study. So it was a good opportunity for me to do that. I was not a model economics student, I should say. I learned enough to be skeptical of most things I read in the paper and be skeptical of most financial advice people give me. Not that I've done all that great on my own, but it was a good, I'm really glad I studied it. It was a very interesting subject at the end of it. So for someone who was not sure what they wanted to do, it was a great major. And I was at UCLA, which is a great center for ideas and people coming through, and you got to hear guest speakers. You know, we heard all kinds of people speak there that as guest lecturers, and it was fantastic. So I don't regret my college years at all. Then I went on a cruise ship. I was studying with Roy Main by that time. I'd been studying with him for about a year after I graduated, not knowing what I wanted to do, and an opportunity came to work on a cruise ship for 4 months, and I did that. So that's where I learned how to play songs and play tunes for gigs, dance numbers, you know, and things like that. So I was able to play dance gigs when I got home and learned a little bit about traditional jazz a little bit and started working more and more on my improvisation. Well, while I was at UCLA, I went to Aspen 2 summers, the Aspen School of Music. At that time, I was a part of the Jazz Fellowship Program. But again, I was really new to jazz. I was not improvising that much. I was playing in big bands and stuff, but not really able to call myself a jazz musician at all. I never really did, though. Anyway, so then I started doing odd jobs around LA when I got back, because I could play dance band stuff, and I was always a pretty good sight reader. I could play shows and do that, and so that went on for a little while. And then a good friend of mine who lives in New York now, who had played in a band, we played in a band together at Disneyland, which is a summer college group called the All American College Band, and we played in that group together. And he called me and said, "Hey, the trombone player for Maynard Ferguson is going to be leaving. You should send in a tape." I said, "I haven't recorded anything." He said, "Well, go record something and send it in." Whoa, okay. So I did that with my friend Dan Levine, who lives in New York. He's a great freelance trombonist on Broadway shows and does other stuff. He's a composer, great all-around musician. And he had a very successful career after college and stuff. So he had asked me if I might be interested in this job. So I sent in a recording to Steve Wiest, who was the trombonist with Maynard at the time. And by then I was starting to do more improvising and playing jazz and more comfortable with it. And I sent in a thing, and Steve said, "Great. When you want to start?" And so I toured with Maynard for 2 years, which was incredible. And so that was my first real sort of name experience. So I did that for a couple of years and had a ball. We'd record a couple of records, toured the United States. I learned a lot about the music education scene in terms of being a player. And we did a lot of clinics. And I kind of got a clinic routine together and watched how Maynard worked with kids. And I talked to a lot of band directors about things. And that was a great education. That part of it was a fine education. Plus the players in the band were spectacular. And I learned so much from them, just hearing them, everyone play every night. So then I came back to town I worked on a cruise ship and I played with Maynard. And not long after that, there was an opening, John Fedchuk and Paul McKee, who had been playing trombone with Woody Herman's band, which was always my favorite band to listen to. They were going to leave, so they turned out that they needed replacements, so I threw my name in the hat there and ended up playing with Woody Herman's band for about a year. Did a tour with them, which was a dream come true for me, because that always been my favorite big band growing up to listen to, with all the trombone players that had been on that band, going back to Carl Fontana and then through to Jim Pugh and Bobby Burgess and all the great, and Birch Johnson, all these wonderful trombonists that had really influenced me. So I got to do it myself, which was one of these moments where I never thought I'd get to do that, and here I was getting to do it. So that was great. And then when I came back from there, I started freelancing a little bit more and worked at Disneyland. That's, and Wayne Bergeron and all the a lot of the players that became members of either the Gordon. Oh no, he's not here. Well, forget it. Is Wayne here? You dog.
Hey,
Hey, Wayne.
I can't see you. I'm in the car.
Oh, good,
But
good. It's good that nobody can see you either.
let me see. Wait a minute. Oh, here we go.
There he is. Hey, Bueno.
What,
Hey,
yo, Alex, what's up, man?
man. Look at you with that sunroof. Look at that. Wow, fancy.
That was amazing.
Hollywood. So some Hollywood shit right here.
Yeah, so Wayne and I did. I sort of helped. We sort of pooled our resources on the band and said, hey, Wayne would be a good guy on this band. We were so wrong, though. It was such a disappointment.
That's right, Alex. I told him that you recommended me for the band. Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. So Wayne came out, it worked out great because he was already famous and everything, but he was able to come in and actually join us. But anyway, so we had a ball out there. Wayne and I were roommates. We stood next to each other on stage, and we were bunkmates on the bus. So we were around each other 20.
I know, Alex.
But we warmed up together. I taught him all of Roy Main's stuff, and he's doing it better than I ever did it. And so that he'll attest to Roy Main's effect as a
Yep,
teacher, I think. Yeah.
I still do those exercises that you gave me, kind of on a regular basis.
Yeah, they're great. So
Yeah, they're
yeah,
awesome.
so that was Maynard's band, and so that was, and then Wayne and I started working a lot in at Disneyland together, and various groups, and subbing out the park and doing all that stuff and shows. We had some good experiences with the shows. We did circus shows and all kinds of stuff there. And Wayne was.
You frozen up. I probably got you.
Yeah, you are. But anyway, it was great, and I love working with Wayne still to this day. I don't know how, but we still work together and put up with each other really well. And I like to tell it. Wayne tells sort of mentions this sometimes. I One thing about him, he's really a fantastic second trumpet player. I mean, n nobody quite appreciates. Everybody knows him as the Wayne they all know from his records and his reputation as a lead trumpet player. He's amazing, of course, but he's also a lot of players in town love playing with him in the section. He's really great at it. I'm not trying to try and talk him down and move him down a chair or anything, but that sort of says something about him as a musician. I think he's every bit as supportive as he is a leader. He's really great that way. And oh, he's back. Look at that. Oh my God.
There
But
we go.
anyway, I was just talking about you. So oh, you're on mute. You're on mute, Wayne. Come on, get it together.
Hey, there we go. Is that better?
That's good. Yeah, but
Okay, yeah.
that's good. And I was just about to mention, actually, Wayne has got his production chops so down. He's so good. We just did a big band record. Did you mention the Tecubus record in your interview, I imagine?
I don't know if I mentioned it or not,
Yeah,
actually.
we just
But
finished.
yeah, we have a new Tom Cubas big band record out called Take Me Out to the Ball Game. I think it's on iTunes now, or it will be in a day or two. But anyway, it came out really great,
Wayne
and
helped produce
Alex
that
has a
thing.
great solo on there,
Oh yeah,
and as well
Wayne.
as all my other
Hey,
colleagues.
Wayne actually plays a really tasty flugelhorn solo, which I kept waiting for all the high notes and they don't come, and it's so great. No, but it's great. It's beautiful. It's really. It's. I think it's. I'm really proud of that record. It sounds great. There's a great Andy Martin feature on there. It's really nice that there's features of, and it's a huge amount of styles, and it's fun. It's some of Tom's best writing for a long time too.
Yeah,
It's
I
really.
think so too, yeah.
It's really fun. Anyway, that's a good plug for that record. I'm so proud to be in that band. We've all known each other
Buy it so I can become a I'll make tens of dollars.
you'll make tens of dollars back.
I have actually money in this thing, hundreds of hours, of course. And then I bought 500 of the CDs. I split it with Tom.
Oh wow.
And
Oh wow.
then I split Charlie Pillard's cost too, who we
Oh yeah.
mixed with.
Yeah.
And so
And
I,
we, I just want to mention real quick, we usually when if we're gonna do stuff in sections like this with the rhythm section and the horns, a lot of times a lot of bands will record the rhythm section first and then they add the horns and the solos after. That's because most of us do it that way. Well, I think it was Trey's idea. I mean, our bass player who's
it was actually my idea.
Oh, it's your idea. Well, forget it.
So
Okay, I'll say it's yours.
what we did, Alex, was, remember we played to Tom's like fake rhythm section, which is pretty good.
Yeah.
And then I had this idea, well, we'll get the horns all done, and then we'll go into a studio with the rhythm section and have the soloist play live with the rhythm section.
And it's so great
So
that.
Yeah, so we got interaction and, you know, and it's.
And I think the ensemble sounds better for it too, because I think in a lot of ways we underestimate how much they react, like to the dynamics and everything of the horns. So when they're playing with the horns, it just makes it better. When a rhythm section is playing a big band tune, recording it without the horns there, they're kind of guessing how hard or how much to dig in, how much to play less. You know, it's just it's such a different thing. So it was really, I think it was very effective.
Exactly. I told them to act like they were playing the chart. This is the gig, and they're playing it. You're hearing this.
Yeah, yeah, it really came out that way. So, yeah,
I'm going to trade credit for my. I don't know if you look. I know you see it says executive producer Wayne Bergeron.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Executive. I like the sound executive. Of that crap right there. There'll be no living with me now.
Oh, no. As if there was. Yeah, it was kind of tricky before, I gotta say.
Well, you have lived with me, so
I have. I lived through you too. That's good. Wayne's great, man. He's just so fun to work with, and we get the job done. We had something the other day that was so fun, and it was made fun, I think, by the way Wayne sort of led the brass section through it. It was great. It was really a fun thing, and it was one of the first times we'd all been together in a room together, which is always is nice. So
I like to say things like encouraging, like don't suck, stuff like that. Stuff that really gets people feeling good about themselves. You know,
you know how you just played that? Yeah, don't do that again.
Yeah. That was perfectly wrong.
It looks like Mark might have a question.
Oh, I was mostly listening to you guys talk, but did you guys join the Fat Band at the same time?
Yeah, that was the original incarnation.
That's right.
Yeah, that was, we did the first recording, and then the band kind of did some live gigs, and that sort of became the band for a while when we started doing a few live things. And Wayne was the original lead trumpet, and I was in the section with Andy, and it was Steve Holtman at that time, and
Rockenbach.
Rockenbach. Bill Rockenbach was playing bass trombone. And then as the band started to travel more, people started to make, you know, a lot of people were less able to make the traveling, and that's kind of where I ended up at a certain point. It was difficult, and also because I had these positions in orchestras, you know, I had the orchestral side of things that I had to be kind of aware of, and a lot of the trips were putting me in conflict with some of those things, so I had to back off. It was like, Gordon, this is either going to be, we either stay friends or you're going to hate me. So for something too much. So I thought it was time to leave.
Actually, what happened was Alex just became a little too big time. He was just a little too busy big band, please.
No, but then
Chris, no, we miss you on the band.
Well, you got Francisco, and Francisco's awesome. Yeah,
so. He's awesome. You know, the band's fun. But it was great having Alex here.
Yeah, I had fun. I loved, you know, some of those guys would go back 30 plus years. So it was a really fun band. So that's good.
Who was in the original trumpet section in the Big Fat Band?
Well, the original for the session, it wasn't the Big Fat Band yet, but it was Gary Grant, Jerry Hay, and I, Larry Hall, and Dan Savant. We had five trumpets. And Gordon was just getting the charts recorded. So we did half of the first record. And then... and when we did the second half of the record, like, you know, Gary and Jerry weren't available, and so other players came into the mix, and but there wasn't really the Big Fat Band yet. That title and everything came later when they were deciding what to call the band, what to call the record, and they called it Swing Over the Fences, and the Big Fat band name was born. But there really was no touring Big Fat Band yet. It was just a record.
It's a studio band, really, in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Gordon Water.
Yeah, I mean, we came in and were reading that stuff. I mean, we were unrehearsed band, you know, so all that stuff from the first CD is read down in the studio.
Yeah.
Yeah. So of all the stuff you guys have done, I'm sure there's some interesting stories that on some sessions the two of you guys have done together. Can you guys think of one or two things that are publicly acceptable share stories?
I remember when Wayne forgot his mouthpiece.
Yeah, I get to a recording session for Gordon's band with no mouthpiece. And
that was good.
I forgot my horns before. Okay, all right, I'm just going to admit it. It's happened before. Not in a long time, but it has happened. But I have a funny story about Alex and I. We were doing a session for a friend of ours, this tuba player named Mike Angelos, and it was in a home studio. And I'm talking about a low budget, you know, home studio.
It was at my house. And
it was?
Yeah, it was
Oh
a
yeah.
Mike, and Mike
Oh, that's
brought
right.
over his Tascam little four track.
That's right. And we only had one pair of headphones. And so Alex and I.
Yeah, we shared a pair of headphones. We wore them. I
You can hear
wore.
the track.
Yeah, we were like this. Like I put on the headphones, and Wayne's head was right
So I can
here.
hear like from the side of it, and we recorded the track that way.
It's, I think it was only because we'd spent that much time on the road that we could deal with.
Yeah, I mean we cuddled and stuff after. I mean,
Out there, you don't want
but
to.
yeah,
Well,
that's that was the weirdest session I've ever done,
and
actually.
it sounded pretty good,
Yeah,
actually, too. It came out okay.
came out great. Yeah.
Now there's a couple of weird things. I'm thinking of actually a weird story, session story that I could think of is one with Andy. Actually, Andy Martin and I were doing something for whoa, who's the composer? Mission Impossible. Wayne, help me out.
Or Giacchino,
No.
or Lalo Schifrin. Lalo
Oh,
Schifrin.
different. Okay, it was a movie called Into the I think In the Sun, Into the Sunset. I think
Oh,
it
I
was.
know.
It
Yeah, I
was.
know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it had it's a big stars in it. Anyway, so we were doing this what's called source music, which is music that you actually hear in the movie as a background, maybe a radio or a band, a live band. That's called source music. And sometimes they bring in the source music from outside, or the orchestra doing the score records the source music. So they had this band that was a Jamaican brass band. You know, the guys with the shorts and the big pith helmets and stuff. And it was very stylized kind of way of playing. It was kind of rough. And they recorded these guys live because it was very hard to recreate the sound with American players. It wouldn't sound the same. So they recorded this band and they sounded cool. It was recorded live in their set outside. So it sounded real. Well, apparently they had a couple of the actors had to sort of, they were in a chase in the middle of this band. So they wanted a couple of the elements to come out. Like they were hiding, one of the guys was hiding behind a couple of the trombone players. So they wanted to have like these trombone players playing that would match the actual sound. So they kept Andy and myself after the session to record this stuff. And so we had the part, and it was just kind of a rough little march thing. And we're playing it, and they say, "You know, guys, it needs to be a little rougher than that." So we go, "Okay." So we kind of just, we started off like that, just playing that one. They say, "No, it needs to be a little rougher." Now it sounds like a good guy sounding rough. Can you make it a little rougher? And Andy and I are looking at each other like, "I don't know what to do." So eventually, what we did is we ended up playing left-handed, like this, out of the side of our mouth. Like, I can't even do it. Like that. It was so funny, and it was like as bad as we could make it. And they went, "Yeah, that's great, you guys." So that was it. And so Andy and I were laughing so hard because we could not make it sound bad enough. So it was just really funny.
And you got overscale for that.
That's right.
They got overscale for that stuff right there. Well, I don't know if you've heard the movie Soul, the opening Disney logo of, we had a studio orchestra and we had to play badly.
Uh-oh.
And
Is he breaking up?
it was very brief.
Breaking up a little
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm
I
just
can I can I can
driving,
feel
so
it. Yeah, so yeah, we had to play really
yeah.
badly.
Yeah, but the movie's Soul, yeah.
Yeah.
Sure,
So
Alex.
yeah, so in this, so we had to go in a session where we had to play the main title with the big with the castle and the Tinkerbell flying over the da-dee, da-da-da-da. But we had to sound like a middle school band. And it took us a while to find that sweet spot, but we found it. And a couple of us, I will admit, recorded a little bit of it on our phones. I have a copy of that sometime. When that movie's kind of out of the mainstream, I might share that little film. It's pretty funny. Dan Fornaro was playing his trumpet upside down, like Terry used to. And I mean, we would have probably sounded better if we'd switched instruments. That probably would have been great. It sounded like that. It was very funny. So every once in a while, we have to sound like a little kids or beginner band, and it's always funny when you're sitting there with all these heroes of some of your favorite players in the world. You all have to play really badly. It's kind of a weird thing, but.
I wish I was at my computer. I have a very good version of that I can share
Yeah.
right now. It's so funny, man.
It's very funny. Yeah, that was good. And then Andy became a star with Soul because he had he played the part of the little girl on the trombone, and it was great. I love the way they animated him to the picture. It was great. They took a lot of time to ensure that the instruments and the way the players played them was very authentic. I was really impressed with that about that movie. The saxophone playing and even the saxophone itself down to the engraving and everything was perfect. It was really, really nice. It was really good. I like that movie.
And you guys have done most of those, a lot of those Pixar movies together also.
Yeah, we've done The Incredibles. So it's always really fun.
Yeah.
You know, there's an ongoing joke. I think Vince DeRosa might've started this when he has something really hard to play over and over and over. Vince used to say, is that blood I taste? You know, it's really brutal. And so it's become a joke with a lot of us to say that. And the Wayne had to do some of the stuff he had to do, especially on Incredibles 2, which was just unbelievable, the stuff that he was doing. And I think somebody might've said at first, is that blood?
And then
Dave Washburn, the trumpet player, said, is that spinal fluid you taste? It was so over the top. I mean, what Wayne had to do in that movie, I really don't know anybody else on the planet that would be able to sort of, there are great trumpet players that could play that. I'm no doubt there's plenty of trumpet players, but to do it as many times as Wayne had to do it, and with this, keeping his attitude as positive as he did without going crazy, I don't know how he did it, but that's Wayne. He's just got that kind of approach. He's going to get it done. You know, he's just,
it's amazing what alcohol can do to help things sometimes. You know, it was always talked about in such a negative light, you know.
No, but he's inspiring in those sessions like that. I mean, it's pretty fun. And Michael's really fun to work with. He's a big fan of music. I mean, he's a big movie music fan, and in general, just pop music and commercial music fan. He loves all the old styles of music and everything. And he loves the players that played on the original soundtracks, and he loves all that stuff. So he makes it very much it's a real communal kind of positive feeling when he does those movies. And I think it affects how we play when we're in the sessions with him. It's really exciting. Movies like that are really exciting to get to do. You feel like you're part of the process more than sometimes when you just walk in and play just, you know, a couple notes here or there and move on. He wants everybody to be as committed as he is to the idea of the movie, not just the music.
Hey Alex, sometimes we go to work, man, and it's super high stress. And sometimes that comes from, you know, who the composer is, you know. But with Giacchino, you know, don't you feel relaxed when you're there? Like the whole vibe is just more relaxed.
It is. He develops really good relationships with the directors. He always has, like, you feel like they're going to go play tennis or go hang out together somewhere after the gig. You feel like he's really connected to the people he works for. And he brings that feeling into the session. And he always makes sure that the higher ups are going, isn't this fun? You know, this is great. Isn't it great to have live musicians on your movie? This is awesome. And sometimes he'll have, like, that percussionist back there playing on the original Planet of the Apes. You know, he'll have this beautiful appreciation for the musicians who are there. And it makes you play better. And, you know, you feel like you're part of the process. Yeah, for sure.
Maybe you guys could talk about that a little bit, because now that the pandemic's definitely not over, but you're starting to play more sessions where you're in the same room. Can you guys talk about the difference between that and what you've been dealing with the past year?
Well, yeah. I mean, most of the recording we've been doing has been at home. And I got to say, I owe that entire ability to be able to do that to Wayne Bergeron. He was so great. He was like my guru getting my home studio stuff from zero and having to just panic and learn Pro Tools, all that stuff, and get up and running on it. Wayne was so helpful and made little videos for me and a couple of the other guys who were in the same situation. And I felt so lucky that he was helpful. And so, again, Wayne, I haven't stopped thanking you for it. But
I'm glad I was able to get some cats up and running, man.
And later on, finding out his health situation the way it was, on top of, you know, after all that. And, you know, he's always been accessible with questions, any of the stuff that, you know, because I'm still a total newbie with this stuff. But anyway, I was able to get functional and actually start enjoying recording at home. And so that was a challenge, and there wasn't that much happening. It was a little bit of here and there, enough to sort of be able to say, okay, we can keep the wolf at the door for another day. But now heading back, you know, there's a lot we have to test every time we go in. Most of the time, there's a lot of distance between us, you know, they put baffles between us or gobos, depending on where you're from, that go between us that that separate us more. And there's a lot of plexiglass everywhere for safety. And you know, those concerns are still there, and people are still worried about a lot of that stuff. We usually have a COVID a doctor or nurse who's on call on site to help make sure that we are wearing our masks when we're supposed to, that we're staying apart from each other, you know. And it's especially hard now, you know, we've been away from each other for a year. Everybody was so excited to see each other again. It's tempting to all of a sudden be face to face talking, catching up, but we have to keep doing that. And also the trend that had been there for a while of recording the brass at night, as I'd mentioned earlier, that's going to be here for a lot longer. And we, when that was happening before COVID, because of either financial reasons or just because it a lot of people mixing the movie, they like to have the brass separate so they have more control over the mix, which, you know, it makes sense. But it's so nice when we're all in the same room. It's great. But I think we're going to be doing a lot of brass dates at night if we, you know, when we get back. Which I'm happy to have any work period right now, and so I'm not complaining about that. But boy, it is so much better when we all do get to play in the same room. It feels better and it sounds better. And I think the effect of the music on the people making the film is more apparent to them when they hear us all at once. I think it sends that energy level up another notch. But that's just my take. I don't know.
You know, Alex, I was thinking, I'm sorry to interrupt, we're cutting each other.
No, go.
I was thinking, I was hoping, we're all recording at home and we're doing Animaniacs reboot. We've been doing these cartoons from home and American Dad and Family Guy, we're going back. We just went back in the studio 2 weeks ago for the first time. But a lot of these things, I was just always afraid that they're going to get used to it like this, and go, oh, look at how much cheaper we can do it. And that probably will happen with some things. I'm guessing we'll stay like this.
I think home recording was already starting to happen a bit before COVID. I think there was a fight going on. I mean, Wayne was doing some stuff with his own albums and recording his own tracks at home a fair amount. And thank God he was, because he was able to help us. But I think that is, like, as Wayne said, I think that's exactly right. A lot of COVID, I think in general, has expedited certain things that were trends anyway. I think it was probably in the future in some form, because the amount of money they're saving on studio time and all this stuff is, for certain projects, is a reality. I think it is so much better. I'm so looking forward to going back together in all these great rooms we have here in LA. I want them to be benefiting from things being back. I want to see all our engineer friends and stage manager friends at these studios that work so hard to get the gigs up and running and make sure that we're taken care of. I want them back at work as much as us.
They've been suffering just like people, us, man.
They're a big part of why people want to come to LA to record. I mean, we're musicians that we're familiar with this kind of work, which is fine. But these people that are in the infrastructure that support all the people that move all the equipment back and forth between the studios, these guys are real pros. They are a full-time moving company, basically. They have to move all the percussion instruments between all the studios. And those guys have to know those instruments and be able to move them safely really fast. And they're pros. They're really good at what they do. And they're suffering right now. You know, all the harpists that have the instruments that have to be moved. I mean, it's a big industry in a lot of ways, bigger than people realize. You know, there's lots of people that are in charge of music editing and all this stuff that are there at work. Sometimes we don't really talk to them or interact too much with them, but they're as important, if you know, a part of the studio recording scene here as any one of us, and by far, you know. So that's that. I want all of us to get back there. You know, that's ultimately the goal. But it is nice to be able to, you know, Wayne and I have done several of these big band projects. We've got a couple that we've done independently that we've been able to record at home that maybe wouldn't have happened at all had we not had access to people with home recording. So there's a positive. I'm able to make recordings for students now. I'm just getting ready to do some orchestral excerpts. I'm coaching a trombone section in a youth group that is, they haven't rehearsed, they haven't gotten together. They've had to just do everything on Zoom. And they're such great troopers. They're hanging in there. So we get together, I have them each play once, one at a time on the Zoom call. But then what I wanna do is I wanna record all their parts and send them each a recording minus their own part so they can have something to practice. So that, you know, it's just something else to do so they at least they can have some of that feeling of playing in a section. And
I've been doing the same thing, Alex. I did a play-along series of 12 big band charts the same way, you know, minus the trombone, sax, all the rhythm section instruments, take the lead trumpet out, And I've been going through it myself, and I'm finding that it's really, it's a great way to practice, because not doing gigs, it's, I just play through the charts and count the rests and everything, and it's great for your endurance.
Yep.
You know.
Yeah. And endurance is something that Wayne is thinking about after coming off a big
long, oh my God,
playing very much and being radiated with chemicals for a few months.
Oh, that was fun. Man, those oncologists, man, they're so funny. Oh, the
heart, oh yeah, like, oh, barrel collapse, yeah,
oh, they're just nothing but fun, you know. But I feel like I'm finally starting to get my mojo back here, Alex. By the way, I played a pop horn session just now, and I'm
good.
And it's the first time I felt like, oh God, I think I'm back, kind of, you know.
Oh, no, like, you sounded great the other day. You had to play some stuff, and it's definitely. I mean, I know you're playing, and I know when you're not happy, and you didn't sound not happy when I heard you the other day. So I'm sure if you're saying you're better, you really are.
It's coming. Yeah, it's definitely coming. I'm starting to get a little more confident. So I'll be back to being an asshole in no time.
Well, that's the other thing about Wayne is I love talking stuff with Wayne about, you know, practicing and music. And you know, it's almost like in certain professional circles, it's almost poo-pooed that you're still kind of an amateur in a way and in all the good ways. And I feel like Wayne and I think myself and a few of us that play, we still want to improve and practice and learn stuff. And we're open to hearing new ideas. There's some great, we're working with some great young players with some different kinds of ideas, and it's exciting, and it invigorates, you know, it's a, you know, you get a puppy for the old dog and the old dog comes to life, you know? And so I feel like that happens with us, and it's so great. I feel like the freelance scene here, and I think it's this way in New York and a lot of places, with all these great movement of players that are around all the time, there's so much to learn all the time. And it's really exciting. You kind of have to almost consciously close yourself off to not benefit from all the ideas and things to work on. There's always something you can work on next and learn. So it's exciting. I feel so lucky to be in this scene. And you know, even with COVID and stuff, it really made it, I think it made us all kind of rethink how we do a lot of things, even on the basic level of practicing. I had to really come up with a practice routine that was flexible, and I could come to, and I'd be motivated to sit down and, you know, play that, look at that trombone and try and make some music with it and make music in other ways and using with the recording technology or whatever, just to be able to come up with ideas and try to keep at it and move forward, not just bad. You know, I know a lot of people just stopped practicing after COVID hit, and I was like, why? You got 6 hours a day you could practice if you want. You know, why not you could put in 2 hours. It shouldn't be that hard. I felt really lucky in a lot of ways to have the practice time, but you know, financially it's been hurting some people really hard who were maybe not as established, especially the people who are not as established in their careers. They've had to think about other things. And I know some people who've expanded into some other money-making options for themselves who are some of our most, you know, the colleagues we see at work all the time, and they've expanded into some other things. And, you know, it's good. I mean, I think maybe that's a good thing for them. And I don't think they're selling out or having to sacrifice being musicians for it. You know, they're still playing and able to balance all those things together. It's interesting how people have reacted to this.
You know, Alex, you and I do this a lot. But when Alex learns something, or he'll always kind of, hey, Wayne, check this out. I figured this thing out. You know, the little exercise we do, I did this, do it. You know, you changed it harmonically. And Alex and I, we've constantly shared this stuff with each other.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, trying to improve on our instruments. And from the time we were on Maynard's band together, we were doing that. You probably talked about that earlier. I mean, we practiced together and learning all this different stuff. And to this day, we still, when we're on a date, you know.
Before a gig, get into our little thing.
What are you playing? What is that you played? And you show me, you know, or whatever, you know. And,
as well as all our dumb inside jokes and music.
Oh, yeah. Alex, nobody will take me seriously.
You're kidding.
like that, for instance. Hey, Alex, you seem ambivalent today.
Yes and no. it's so corny, yeah.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
We have a Laurel and Hardy act.
Oh well, yeah.
Yeah, we have our.
It's not that good.
Is there? Good. Did I miss something, Alex? Did I miss one of our routines? Oh, yeah.
No. Well, those are the good ones. Unfortunately, yeah. That's as good.
Unfortunately, that's the as good as it gets.
Yeah.
You're kidding.
Yeah, you're kidding. Yeah.
Anyway, hey, you guys, Alex and Mark, love you guys. I got to go.
All right, Wyndham.
And it's great. Carry on, Alex. And I'm proud to be your friend, man. And
oh, likewise.
Kicking butt, man, like you do, buddy. And I'll see you. I know I'll see you soon here. So
yeah.
We're.
Yeah.
And you have to tell me about how you liked Gus's fried chicken, by the way. And that's
Oh my God. Wayne recommended a fried chicken place you got to go to. I mean, coming from the South, Mark, it might be like in the pocket, maybe. I think it might compete. What do you think, Wayne? With someone
it's, right, it's a Memphis place. It's Gus's world famous fried chicken from Memphis.
Yeah.
And they have a couple out here. And it is it's ridiculous.
Yep.
Are we supposed to be talking about trombones and trumpets? We're talking about food all of a sudden. It's completely ridiculous. Don't you agree, Alex?
Oh yeah, it's great. A great place, and people are great. Really nice. Everybody's cool there, and it's a great place. So, Mark, you got to come out. Wayne and I—it'll be Wayne's treat. He'll take you there.
Of course.
That sounds good. That sounds
all
good.
All right, you guys. I'll let you go, man. Have a great day.
Take it easy, Wayne.
Thanks, Wayne, so much.
See you, man. Bye.
Go practice.
Bye.
Thing is, he probably will. That's a.
So for that, everybody, and for everybody worried that they're for some reason I can't turn the subtitles off. So, but when I publish this on YouTube, they won't be there because it's.
Okay.
I don't know what
that was.
Horrible thing I've done on YouTube. I mean, on Facebook, but
okay, it's all right. It's
Zuckerberg's fault.
I have a lot of hearing impaired friends that you know that would appreciate this. So that's okay.
That's all right. So. Man, there's so much stuff we've covered. And I have some questions.
Oh, yeah.
I just want to go back.
Wayne threw a wrench in the works in a beautiful way.
No. Oh, I knew that was coming. I just didn't know when. But that was actually the timing of that was perfect.
That's
so,
great.
Because you guys brought up Disney
yeah.
Land World.
Disneyland. Yeah.
Disneyland. I'm so sorry. At the same time. So I wanted to kind of go back to. You know, when you were growing up as a kid, who were your trombone heroes? Who were you listening to?
Oh boy, probably my biggest trombone heroes, the two biggest ones I had. Well, I guess, well, let's say two, were Jim Pankow from Chicago. I mean, I was really influenced by him as a kid because here was a trombone player who was cool. You know, that was like that. Wow, that somebody's actually out there on a big stage playing to thousands of people, playing the trombone and playing it well, like a really good trombone player. And he was as a writer and arranger. I thought so highly of him. And it's like that. Wow, what a dream existence to have is to be this really great artist and be able to have a pop following like that. That was kind of cool. I was really impressed by that. And then the other trombonist, primarily that influenced me so much and to this day is Dick Nash, who's the studio trombonist, the capital T. Capital T trombone and two trombones, the studio trombonist of all time. Most heard trombonist. Nobody will have a career like him. Nobody will play the trombone like him. He was just, and what was amazing about Dick Nash to me is he was a great player that I looked up to with all the recordings he did with Henry Mancini and over the years. He was a good improviser, great jazz player, and he played with John Williams, everybody. And the thing that impressed me is I kept hearing about him doing all this great music, and I heard all these beautiful solos, and I could pick him out on records after a while. Like, it's Dick Nash. And then I found out he played bass trombone. He was great. He played on the Art Pepper Plus 11 record, if you ever hear that. He plays bass trombone, subbing for George Roberts, and he plays it great. It's like, oh my gosh, now another side of this guy. I never knew. And then as what happens with, very often, I'm sure you've had this experience, Mark, where you meet your heroes, and you know, they're great, they're wonderful musicians, and they're nice people too for the most part, but there's always something when you meet them in person. Sometimes your heroes kind of, sometimes they let you down a little bit. They're not quite as amazing as players as they are as players. There's something about them that is kind of like, oh, they're kind of, you know, they're maybe a little gruff. Maybe you catch them on a bad day. You know, it could be anything, but they kind of, there's somehow that it just knocks them down a little bit in your mind. They're human, you know, they're a human being. Maybe you made them out to be too big a thing or whatever. Well, Dick Nash, it was the exact opposite. When I first met him, I met him after a concert, and he was so wonderful. And I just remember him. I said, I'm a trombone player. And I was real shy, and he just was immediately, you know, like pretend to break my arm. Oh, you're a young trombone player, huh? Okay, I'm gonna break your arm. You know, and he was just really fun and just joking around. And then I started working with him a little bit off. You know, the first time I ever worked with him, I actually met him on the tennis court in person first, because he was a big tennis player, and I used to play doubles with this group of people. And the guy said, "Oh yeah, a trombone player sometimes joins us named Dick Nash." And I went, "What?" And so I actually met him on the tennis court, and he was great. He was a very good player, very good golfer, and very good tennis player. And we used to play tennis, and he was just a ball, just fun. Reminded me of my dad. He just had that sort of feeling where you have a good relationship with somebody who's a mentor, and you just really liked the guy. So he was just wonderful. It's like, gosh, he's such a great player, and he's such a nice person. Well, I got called for a friend of mine had a jingle, actually a trailer, I think it might have been, or a European commercial. It was a big orchestra, and we were playing some sort of Magnificent Seven style music. And so I'd always play first trombone for this composer friend of mine. And he came up to me before the session. He's like, "Hey, guess what?" I said, "What?" "Guess who's playing second trombone today?" And I said, "Who?" He said, "Dick Nash." I said, "No, Dick Nash is not playing second trombone. He's playing first." He's like, no, I want you to play first trombone." And I said, "Well, Dick Nash is here. You can't have him on second trombone. He's the guy. You know, you want him on first." He said, no, I really want you to play first today." And I said, "Well, okay." So I sat down in the first chair, and Dick walked in, walked right over to the second chair, sat down. I said, "Dick, I'm sorry. I feel kind of weird playing for." He's all, no, it's composer you work for. That's fine. Don't worry about it. Yeah, I'm not worried about it." Well, they copied the music out on one line. So it was first and second on one line, and then third and tuba on another page. So they kind of cut the corners on the copying the parts. So it was first on top, second on bottom. So we're running the, we ran through the piece the first time with the click and everything, and we're playing, and I noticed Dick played the first part. So we're doubling. And I was like, "Uh-oh." So we're playing, and we play through the first 8 bars, and they cut us off. They're going to adjust mics and stuff. And Dick leans over to me. He's all, "You have to forgive me. I'm used to playing first." And he was so beautiful. It was just so nice and so natural. And we had so much fun. It was like what I was saying about Wayne. You know, Wayne's a great second trumpet player. And section trumpet player. I mean, he's wonderful in the section. He's not an, like so many, what happens with a lot of soloists or principal players, they're not as, they're sometimes the first to admit, they're not as adept at following. It's not in their, they're used to leading, and that's just the way they are. It's nothing wrong, but it's so interesting when you meet somebody who's both, you know, it's inspiring. So I he actually ended up becoming the second trombone player with this particular composer. So for several years, whenever I worked with this composer, Dick was playing second trombone, and he was so fun. He had such a ball on the sessions we did. And he'd bring in recordings, and we listened to him on the break. He'd have a little portable tape, you know, like CD player he'd bring. And it was like hanging out in your dorm room in college. He was so enthusiastic. He's like, "Hey, I got this recording of Carl Fontana. Let's listen." And he would point out things and listen to what he does on this. He was as into it. He was a guy, he's close to 80 years old, and he was every bit as into the music and other musicians and the whole thing as he was when he was probably in his teens. I mean, it's just inspiring. And so I always think of that, that experience with him. And it's pretty rare thing to come across people like him. He's a rare breed.
You know, it's funny you bring that up, because I noticed Jerry was watching and Larry Hall's been watching, and both of those guys say hi, nice things. And I mean, even though they're not playing anymore, they're still so enthusiastic about music.
Oh, because
it's just so fun. And all it's the stuff I've seen with you, the enthusiasm, I mean, it's just contagious.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what that was the other thing I was thinking about. Like, you know, can you describe like the atmosphere? Because you're a SoCal guy originally. Can you kind of describe the atmosphere around town as you're growing up and all the things that that were coming onto your plate to digest?
You know, it was pretty amazing because there were so many different things. You know, I feel so old now talking about this, but like when Mike Sachs and I were at UCLA at that time, you know, at Royce Hall on any given night, there was something. Even if you didn't go to the concert, we'd sneak in and go listen to the rehearsal. And whatever it was, whether it was a big orchestra traveling through town or Pat Metheny's group was pretty new, they were playing, we'd go listen to them. And I mean, it was amazing. You could hear all this great music. And then just the clubs around town, the different things that were happening. There was a club in Venice Beach that just played Brazilian music. I mean, you could go hear good Brazilian music every like two or three nights a week. there were clubs that specialized in other kinds of music, and it was everything on the map you can imagine: pop, singer songwriter things, avant-garde music, all kinds of crazy concerts at Pershing Square. They would have like public concerts of new composers writing all this great stuff to be performed outside. And I that's where I got developed a playing relationship with Bruce Fowler, who's a fantastic trombonist. He used to play with Frank Zappa, and I used to play in his trombone group, which was called Enormous Bones. And we used to do concerts. We'd do concerts down at the Santa Monica Beach, and we'd go out there and we performed with this contemporary dance group, and we did all these crazy pieces that Bruce would write. Some of it was just, there was no music. He would just sort of say, okay, you're going to play this for a while, and then I'll play this. And then there'd be like eight of us out there playing, and we're out there on the beach, and everybody's just like surfers, and everybody, and there are these dancers that were like doing all these poses and doing all this stuff. It was crazy. It was so fun. And we're in the water. We're up to our knees with our horns playing all this stuff. And we did some live concerts that were sort of performance art things with Bruce. And, you know, Bruce was a phenomenal trombone player when he used to play with Zappa. And then he went on to become one of the busiest, if not the most requested orchestrators for film. He's with Hans Zimmer and a lot of other composers. And so we still see him at work doing that. He's great. And he's a fan. And he's so, being a trombonist, he always makes sure we had great parts to play. So, and he'd always make sure there was a lot of us there. You know, sometimes we'd have a trombone. We'd have these trombone sections with like eight trombones, you know, on a movie. And it was great, you know, and they'd write all these great parts for us to play. And, you know, and so Bruce is a huge influence too. I mean, he's and as a player, I played in a couple big bands with him, and he would play these solos that were just so inventive, so different. And then, you know, as I got older, as far as influences, you know, I was really influenced by players like Bill Watrous and, of course, J.J. Johnson, and the traditional sort of jazz trombonist. Like, J.J. was a huge influence. I have, you know, at all his records, I transcribe his solos, and he was always so accessible and so meaningful in everything he played. Everything had a place and was so founded in a solid structure. And it turned out he was a great composer and arranger as well, just an awesome musician. And, you know, you keep learning about him the more you get to know about him. It's just, besides the great trombone playing, and another man who was a gentleman, a beautiful person. And and then players, the local players around here, some of the other jazz players, like Britt Woodman lived here. He used to play with Duke Ellington. He's an incredible trombone player, totally underrated by a lot of trombonists even. Britt Woodman, a wonderful trombonist. And then George Bohannon, who was a wonderful jazz trombonist in the studio, and also studio trombonist, playing a lot of pop records in the 60s and 70s, and a great post-J.J. Johnson type jazz player. I mean, there were so many musicians and trombone players and other kinds of music going on. It was, you just turn your head and there'd be somebody to check out. We used to sneak into the jazz clubs here. My dad would take us in. They'd have jam sessions at a couple of the local high schools on a regular basis that you could go hear these people play. You know, of course, I heard Jack Sheldon and Blue Mitchell and all the great trumpet players that were around here then, Connie Condoli. And I mean, these people were just incredible. And just so, it just came out of them like nothing. And I was so lucky to be around that sound. And I at that time, I had no connection to it as myself as a player, but it got in there, you know, and it definitely affected me. And as I got interested in doing jazz myself, I would say that experience as a kid of being surrounded by that was really important experience.
And you played on a couple of Bill Watrous's albums also.
Right? Yeah, I think I did. I played with him a few times, but Bill was amazing. I mean, his whole approach to the trombone, which was had a lineage to it. I mean, he was inspired by another big influence of mine, Herbie Green. Every year I go through a little period where I pull out my Herbie Green records, I pull out my JJ records, or I pull out my Jack Teagarden records. I pull those out and I listen to them again and I go, geez. And it gets me the same way it got me when I was 13, 14 years old. There's something about the way those gentlemen play that has really stuck with me and I come back to a lot. Carl Fontana is another one, and Frank Rossellino is another one. I mean, there's something about those people. There's a charisma to their sounds. And I always, you know, that first big band record that Bill Watrous recorded was such, it changed everything for trombone players. It was a whole other way of playing the instrument and mastering technique on the trombone that nobody had ever touched. I mean, I guess the closest thing I could think of that was that I experienced later is the first time I heard Jaco Pastorius play, where he kind of reinvented the instrument. It was kind of amazing to be in a place and time where that happened. You know, maybe when Charlie Parker played saxophone, you know, or Dizzy Gillespie or Clifford Brown played, you know, to hear that happen, changes everybody's way of thinking immediately. And Watrous was that way with trombone. For a lot of us who were, you know, 13, 14 years old, hearing that for the first time was like, what is this, you know?
Well, I was going to ask you, I'll come back to Maynard in a second, but were you on the Big Bop Nouveau tour?
I did that. When first time he put the big band back together after you having a smaller group for a while. Yeah, that was exciting.
Well, when I was in high school, I heard Carl Fontana. I played in an all-state jazz band with Bill Watrous, and then I heard you play with Maynard.
It was a letdown. No. I mentioned earlier, Mark, I love playing jazz and I love learning about it and I'm inspired by it on a day-to-day basis, but it's unfair and not it's a disservice I feel for me to call myself a jazz musician. I'm in awe of people who really are, you know, that actually have been able to focus that much on being that type of player. I love improvising and I love the music and I love participating in it, but it's really more about just joy and participation for me than it is that kind of focus that you have to have, I think, to really be the kind of player like Carl or you know, like I think Andy Martin is the player I work with, and Bob McChesney and Scott Whitfield. There are players here that I feel are the ones that really make me realize that, man, I'm lucky to get to play with those guys. I'm happy with that role. I love being able to play with those guys, and if you know, being able to play a solo, you know, after they do, or hopefully before they do, you know, that's my joy. I love it. I've gotten to the point now where I actually enjoy getting my butt kicked pretty hard. It's happened enough times now. It's good for me. I love it. You know, so it's. Well,
and I was going to ask you some questions about how you approach that. But while we're talking about some of these older players, can you talk about that period of Maynard and what that was like?
Wow. Well, like I said, it was a great education on a lot of levels. Maynard was all about joy. Everything he did, the person you got at the concert was pretty much the way he was all the time. He really loved sharing music. That was more than anything. He wanted nothing in between himself and the band and the music. He loved his band, he loved to play the trumpet, and he loved the audience, and he loved music. It's like anything that would put any kind of crimp in that relationship, he had no interest in. It was like, he didn't like the business very much. He didn't like the, you know, he was good at tolerating promoters and all that. He was great. He could put up with a lot of stuff. And I had seen him have to act very quickly and think quickly on a couple occasions, and he did it, which was amazing to me because he did not put that across at all. But it was really great having to play on that level of energy every night, and to see him at his age at that time doing that every night for a room full of fans or two people in a club. It didn't matter. He was 100% pedal to the metal every time he played his instrument. And it was inspiring to see it once or twice. You know, as growing up, I'd see him play. Well, that was cool. It was really great. I love Maynard. That's great. Or listen to his records. That's great. But then you actually go out and you see him do it night after night after night. Unbelievable. Unbelievable that he was able to harness that kind of energy. And despite having a bad night, you'd be up there the next day fighting, getting right through it. You know, like it was amazing. And, you know, and there was always good and bad his whole career that he would, you know, have off nights and good nights, and he was the first to admit it because that's the way he played. He was not going to compromise and play it safe ever. And I think that's kind of the approach that Arturo Sandoval has when he plays. He's pedal to the metal, man. You're going to get him 100%, 110% when you go to hear him play live. It's the same. It's a very, I can tell maybe that's a little bit of the Maynard in him that he saw in Maynard. But it was great, and I loved how Maynard was on the road. He knew how to keep people. He was not interfering with the way the band ran. He'd once in a while say something if it wasn't what he wanted, but basically the band ran itself, and it was very self-contained. You know, like rhythm section players would work out new things, horn section, we tried different licks, like background licks, maybe we would change something. Let's play that long. Okay. And we'd do stuff. We were constantly changing up the repertoire that we played. And we played basically on any given tour. You were playing the same tunes every night for periods of time. And then you had your solo feature. Everybody had at least one solo feature. And I had a big long blues thing that I had to play when I was on the band. And that's what Steve Wiest had started that. He had a big feature thing on a blues tune. And he would play cadenza for 5 minutes. And so that's when I joined the band, Maynard expected me to do that. So I had to like figure that out. And I'd turn into something I really enjoyed doing. It was really fun. And, you know, I'd get into some other, they'd give me a chance to play with some multiphonics and do some funny stuff like that. And it gave me a chance to experiment every night with a little bit of stuff. So that was, and to be able to have the honor to be allowed to do that and get paid a little bit of money on the road, it was a great experience to get to do that. I felt very spoiled getting that opportunity to play with him. And he was always really good to me, very very friendly, very positive, and encouraging. And he was that way with everybody in the band, even the people he fired. He had to fire people while I was on the band, and he handled it so beautifully. He made them feel like they were going to get another chance, and some of them did. He gave them a strong feeling that this is a new beginning for them. I mean, it was amazing. He was very good at that. And wow. I appreciated the fact that he was able to say goodbye to people when it became time, you know. So that was really good. That wasn't always the case on some of the road bands that my friends were doing, or acts that they were doing, you know, on the road. It's like, you're gone. It was not very pleasant, you know. It could be a pretty unpleasant experience, but he was great. Yeah, it was a really great experience. And like I said, between playing every night and then getting the teaching opportunities and examples that I was getting from him and from the other players in the band, unbelievable. Like graduate school in a lot of ways. Yeah,
there's not a lot of, you know, that he might have been the last of them that was doing so many clinics and schools and things like that. That it's not as common. I mean, I really can't think of anything that happened.
Well, the one place I do see it happening are the military bands. They're like kind of they're the last vestige of the road band thing. And those bands are killing it. You know, they sound great. The Army Ambassadors, the Airmen of Note, I mean, the Navy Commodores, all of them, they're fantastic bands and great players. And a lot of those players, I believe, had they not gone into those military bands, they probably would have gone on the road with some of the bands that we've mentioned, you know. They would have been out there on Basie's band or Woody's band or Buddy's band or any of those bands that were big in the 70s and 80s, you know.
What about, and so not long after that, you also went out with Woody Herman, who was like a huge idol of yours. Yeah. Talk about that experience, because at what point in Woody's career were you around? It's toward the
end.
Good question.
He was sick. When I joined the band, he was not touring with the band. Frank Tiberi was fronting the band. And Woody actually passed away when we were, I think we were here in Hollywood the night he passed away. And so it wasn't a big surprise, but it was very sad. It was really interesting. I was out there with the other trombones were John Allred and Joe Barati, who Joe played for many years with Harry Connick and freelanced in New York. And John Allred is one of my favorite jazz trombone players of all time. He's in that same league. I put him in the same league as Carl or Frank Rösslinger or even J.J. Johnson. I think he's as special a jazz trombonist as you can find, and just plays right down the middle, straight ahead, swinging music that every time I hear him play, I feel better for having heard him. And it was a pleasure to hear him play every night. You know, he'd go out front and play on Apple Honey, the fast rhythm changes. And it was amazing to me because he'd play that tune maybe, you know, six times in a week, and I'd never hear him repeat himself. I mean, it was just this huge bottomless pit of ideas and spontaneity, and anything that came into his head he could play, and he had incredible technique on the trombone. Yeah, it was really quite an experience to hear those guys. And then Greg Gisbert was playing jazz trumpet, incredible. Charlie Pillow, who's now in New York doing great, he was on the jazz in one of the tenor sax players. Frank Tiberi, of course, who was an incredible tenor player, totally underrated as a jazz musician, from Philadelphia, knew Coltrane, and he was a devotee in a lot of ways. He understood John Coltrane's playing as better as well as anyone I've ever met. And Ron Stout playing jazz trumpet. Roger Ingram was playing lead trumpet with me, as well as Eric Miyashiro. So it was a pretty heavy band. It was really great. And playing all those charts, those old charts, and the newer ones too, the John Fetchock stuff that was so great. John Allred and I both played some of John's features when we played, which was a treat. You know, my dream as a kid, when I'd go to the Carnation Plaza at Disneyland, which was an outdoor dance little dance hall. And when Woody's band would come and play there, they would sort of rope off the dance part of it, and all the kids would jump and sit on the ground and listen to the band on the ground right in front of the band. And I did that every time Woody was in town. I heard Jim Pugh play there, and I heard Fetchock play there. And it was always like to see one of the trombone players come out front to the microphone and play one of those big solos with Woody's band. I said, "Oh my God, that is so cool." And when I was at Disneyland playing with the band, and I got to go out front myself and play a solo, it was really something. That was a very personal experience that I was. It was very pivotal in my gratitude meter went way up, and it's like not many people get an opportunity to get to do that, and I felt extremely lucky that all the planets had aligned that I was able to do that. John leaving when he did, me being available when I was, me being able to play, at all, I'd be able to play at the level that it was necessary to get on the band. I was very lucky. I was very lucky. And also, I was lucky with my road experience in general. I did it just long enough before I think a lot of people stay out on the road for a long time. A lot of the big band guys at that time, and I say guys because they were all guys then, a lot of those players, I think, stayed out. And it and the that life is can really wear you down, and you lose all your contacts in a place. You want to move somewhere and live, and it's like you've been out of the road for 5, 6, 7, 10 years. It's really hard to get established. I was out for 2, 3 years at the most total with my road experience. So I was back in town enough. I sort of kept my friends and contacts and work happening in town. So I was able to come on off the road and actually benefit from returning. So that was good. I was lucky, and that was just luck too. I probably would have stayed out longer if I hadn't had a few things going on in town here that kept me here. And I also got married not long after the second tour with Maynard, with the Big Bop Nouveau. So that was all. That all worked out. It was just kind of the timing was kind of perfect. So it was
It sounds
good.
like you learned so much from those. Can you talk about your approach to improvising? Is that something you picked up when you were in those bands, or
Yeah,
what were you
well, it
or
I grew a lot in that time. Yeah, my experience with jazz was so, like I said, so reverse engineered. I listened a lot, and I would try and imitate, but I didn't have good ears. I wasn't good at transcribing when I was younger. I didn't know that you were supposed to do that. Nobody pushed me. I was one of those people that probably should have been like some great jazz piano player said, "Kid, this is what you need to do." Nobody did that for me. There was no one on my radar that did that. I just liked to play, and I messed around, and sometimes I'd hit some good notes, and I could play the trombone, and I was listening to the way the music felt to me, and I could co sort of imitate that feeling. But oh man, I was terrible. I played wrong notes left and right. I didn't know what to do. So when I went to Aspen, I went as a jazz on a jazz fellowship because I was playing in the big band. So I also took some lessons in a class with a fellow from the University of Miami, who everybody who went through Miami at that time knows this guy. His name is Vince Lawrence Maggio. Vince Maggio. He was a fantastic improv coach and teacher, and he was a great jazz pianist. He played briefly with Phil Woods. I mean, he was a real good bebop pianist. He could also do like a dead on impersonations of other pianists. You do Errol Garner, and he knew all the beautiful voicings. He could talk about voicings and how to get through chord changes, and he was good at talking about it. And he would listen. He would give us little things to work on, give us a tune, give us some scale ideas. Very simple, not too much information at once, and then had us play. And he worked on our time really hard. He was really a stickler for that. And I basically learned how to play over 2-5-1 progressions with him. And they said, "Now go listen to this person, and this is how they do it." And that was what I needed. I said, "Where were you when I was 15?" That's what I always used to say to him. But he got me going, and I started to learn how to play over chord changes a little more consistently. And then after that, I was listening to music with new ears. So I could, oh, okay, now that's what's going on. So it was this long process of imitation and learning how to do things that way. and a lot of, you know, Music Minus One stuff and that too. And then eventually going to jam sessions. You know, it took me a long time to get up the nerve to do things like that. In Orange County in the 70s, there were several clubs in town that were kind of weird jazz clubs. They would be mostly, they'd play some straight ahead stuff, but they did a lot of fusion-y kind of jams too. So you never knew what you were going to get. You'd walk in, it might be just some one chord vamp and you had to get up and blow. So I got more comfortable with that too. Played funk, the other kinds of music. I always loved rock and roll. Like I said, I loved Jim Pankow, and I later discovered Fred Wesley and Wayne Henderson and all the source of that kind of playing. And that was always a big part of my upbringing too. I loved all that style of music. So that's sort of where I came in improvisation too, was from like funk and soul and R&B and rock kind of playing too. So I was not a traditional kind of jazz musician at any point, you know. And it was always kind of this weird kind of way of, I had peaks and valleys in my skill sets. So but it was good. And I, you know, lately I've been practicing more and more. There's so many great things on YouTube. I'm a big fan of Adam Neely. Mm-hmm. The pianist, Peter Martin's one of the pianists. These two pianists that have a show called You'll Hear It, which is basically about piano jazz, but they talk a lot about music in general. And it's like you're hanging out with these two guys, and they'll talk about how Herbie Hancock does this, and it's like, oh my gosh, this is all the information. You here's this time to hang out with somebody and really learn. And I found that very useful. And I'm trying to go back, and I'm always trying to learn more of that stuff. And I'm inspired by some of the great young jazz musicians that are out playing now, that are, you know, the players in New York. There's so many great players in New York right now. Elliot Mason, Marshall Gilkes, Ryan Kirby, and there's so many great players out there. Vince Chandler, Wycliffe, of course. I mean, it's just a ton of great players to be inspired by, and all coming at it from slightly different angles and playing music that isn't necessarily straight ahead jazz. It's sometimes really interesting, different kinds of jazz, and improvisational music with interesting harmonies and totally different kind of music than what I was growing up listening to. And I love it. All that music is inspiring. So I'm still a big jazz fan. I'm more of a jazz fan, I think, than I am as a player. You know, I love getting up and playing a solo here and there, but I'd say I'm more of a fan of the music, technically. You know,
well, even though you do it at an incredibly high level. I mean, there's a lot of your transcriptions and things I've seen on online, and you know, and some recordings and stuff that sound great. I mean,
thanks.
But you are also obviously an excellent classical trombonist too, and you've played with the LA Phil, LA Chamber Orchestra, San Francisco Symphony. Can you kind of talk about that side of your playing, sure, a little bit, and how you develop that, and who you're listening to for that?
Sure. Well, one thing for me, I would say, if there's one thing about me, I try to look at music as a big thing. And I think that there are certain skill sets you need for certain kinds of music. Obviously, for playing lead in a jazz band, or playing a solo chair in a group, or having your own group, there are certain skill sets that are important to each one of those things. Playing in a brass quintet is very different than playing in an orchestra. You need to kind of know what the gig's about and what the music's about. And right. So that's always been something I've been very aware of. And I've always, because I wasn't a music major, I've always had this survey approach to music. I've tried to look at it in as big a picture as I can. And I also, I'm greedy. I love playing different kinds of music, and I don't want to sacrifice and put aside one thing. No, you should focus on something one at a time, young man. I reject that notion. I rebel against that. So as far as the classical side of trombone playing and orchestral, especially orchestral playing, I started off that way. I mean, that's what I was doing when I knew Mike in high school. You know, I played in the All-State Orchestra with all these great players, including Mike, and players who went on to get jobs with big orchestras and stuff. So I kind of had an awareness of it. I kind of let it slip a little bit in college until I went to Aspen. When I went to Aspen on the jazz fellowship, they still let me take lessons and get in the orchestra rotation. They needed trombone players. So everybody there was so nice. They knew what I was there for, but they were encouraging me and very positive and gave me lots of feedback. One of the players who was in the at Aspen with me was a great trombone player. Plays with where is he at now? Is it Pittsburgh? No, he's not Pittsburgh. He's Canadian. Peter Sullivan. Does he play with
he's in Pittsburgh. Yeah, he's a great
Pittsburgh. Yeah, he's in Pittsburgh. Okay. Peter was playing, and he was kind of the hot shot, right? He was the first trombone with the top orchestra most of the time, and he was great. He played a master class. Everybody go, okay, we're done. You know, he was the guy that everybody was looking up to, and Peter was great, and he was so positive with me. I remember because he was sort of intrigued with me as having more of a little bit. I had my 2B, my little jazz trombone out there, as well as my large tenor. So he was always, oh, that's really interesting. And then one day he had to play bolero. I'll never forget this. He had to play bolero with the concert orchestra at Aspen. And he was really frustrated. I heard him rehearsing it. He sounded great, but he was really, yeah, I don't know if he was hearing footsteps. That's typical with that solo, you know, with trombone. It's not, no matter how good you are, it's always knocking at your door and making you paranoid. So he said, can I try your horn, your small tenor? And I said, sure. So he brought it into the rehearsal that night. And he played it on the concert too. He played my 2B and he sounded great on it. It was so funny. And he said, since then, you know, he could play a bass trombone and sound great on bolero probably, but it was so fun. He was so open to that. I had a whole level of respect for him jumping in on and making a little solution, coming up with a solution, you know, and I didn't even hear him struggling with it. It was so funny. I think it was all in his head, but you know, but I'm not going to argue with him.
Was James Jenkins and Sax there at Aspen at the same time?
Actually, okay. Sax was at the other festival over the hill.
Right?
What was that?
It was a Colorado Music Festival?
It was maybe the Colorado Music Festival. What city was that in? But he was over the hill. He came and visited. But James was, he was at the second time. I think he was at the second festival. And I knew James. He was my roommate in the All-American College Band at Disneyland. And so he was, I loved James. He was great. He was our wise person that made everybody calm down when we were freaking out and acting like idiots. James was the one who was able to say, look, you guys, calm down. He was great. I can imagine him being the best teacher ever as a tuba teacher. He's such a calm, centered guy. I just always really, really loved him. He had a lot of fun. He was just a fun person. I loved him. And then he was at Aspen. We kind of reunited there that a couple years later. But yeah, there were some great players there then. But it was really nice to. So after that, I kind of let it go. I let the orchestral thing go. I was doing commercial music, all that stuff. So then I was at Disneyland. This is after the road and after all that stuff. And I'm at Disneyland. And I'd heard that the local orchestra was having a second trombone audition. And this is like 1989. So this is about 4 or 5 years after Maynard and all that stuff. So I went, well, why not? You know, I'll get the list. It was a short list, as it turned out. I was like, I'll give it a shot. I'll listen to the recordings and practice. And I was doing a show at Disneyland at the time. And it was a great schedule because we would play a 20-minute show and then have an hour off. Another 20-minute show, I have 2 hours off. So I had a big breaks. So I just go back up into the dressing room and blast excerpts for 2 hours and then go play the show, blast excerpts for a couple hours. And it was great. And there was another trombonist working at the park at the time who was in another group on the other side of the park. And he was doing the same thing. So sometimes we'd play off each other. We'd sort of train together a little bit or talk about the excerpts or whatever. It was fun. So, and I had no expectation. I was just doing this purely for the experience of taking an audition. Well, I was, I guess maybe because I just wasn't nervous and I was playing pretty well because I was playing a lot. I got to the finals. I didn't win the job, but I made the finals, which was really kind of unexpected for me. I was as surprised as anyone. And then when that happened, I started subbing a little bit with the orchestra. And then so this word, I think I, without realizing, I kind of created this little buzz that, okay, here's this guy who did cruise ships, was working at Disneyland and toured with Maynard and Woody. Wait a minute, he got through an audition with, you know, pretty well in this local audition. And suddenly I started getting studio calls. That's actually when the studio work started to pick up because most of the, especially back then, there was a lot of big differences in style between day to day. You big band one day, orchestra another. And so they generally needed players that could switch gears pretty easily and be comfortable playing large equipment if it was orchestral and a smaller tenor if it was that. So for some more pop or jazz band stuff. So that I just, again, pure luck. I didn't plan it. I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to make this big career change. I I had no plan at all. I was just following a musical thing that I wanted to do. And so that's where it helped. And then I kind of got into it. And as I was starting to play more, I was subbing and getting to sit next to the guy who won that job. Actually, it was a fellow named Mike Hoffman, who's a fantastic orchestral trombonist, one of the best I've ever heard. And I got to play second trombone to him playing Mahler 3 with the big trombone solo in it. And it was spectacular. I mean, it was a clinic. You know, he was just, and so I had this great experience of getting to sit next to these players who really were orchestral players. And so then that kind of went on, and I'm subbing in the local orchestras. And then by then the internet's getting to be bigger, and I'd had a contact with over the internet about something to do with some trombone equipment or a gig bag or something with Pete Ellison. And we traded emails, and it turned out he was playing in the Seattle Symphony, and he'd heard me play with Tom Kubis's band, and he'd heard my name through session work, because they were doing session work up there quite a bit then. And we developed a friendship just over the internet, trading stories and whatever. And he said, hey, you should do Joe Alessi's seminar. It's in the next one. It's in 2001. You should do it. And I said, really? I'm like, he said, no, you'd have fun. You're starting to do some more orchestral playing. It'd be perfect. I think you'd really get a lot out of it. So I sent in a demo tape on a mini disc player. I sent in I created a cassette from the mini disc, fired it off, and Joe accepted me as a participant at the seminar in 2001. So, wow, that's great. So I went there, and it's a who's who. There was 12 tenors and 4 basses, and they were all young players at the time. The players all went on to do great. Paul Pollard, Colin Williams, Jamie Williams, who plays in Europe now. Christian Jensenko plays with Cincinnati. I mean, it was heavyweight players on all through the group. So I was in, and they were all much younger than me at the time. I was about 40 at this time. And I was still a total newbie when it came to orchestral playing. So I just had this fantastic experience. And so then I ended up doing this whole kind of about face in my playing from this experience. I really had a major change in about, I came back from that seminar after Joe working with me, and really, I said, treat me like one of your Juilliard students. I mean, it's just, I want you to be honest and just, I want it to be the real thing. And he didn't hold back, and he was great. And he really shared some, I came back on the plane. I'm on the plane on the ride home, and I made a list, and there were 20 things I came back that I knew I needed to work on if I wanted to get more serious about playing orchestral music. And that became, that was my list I kept for 3 or 4 years after that. And in the process, in 2002, I auditioned and I won the job with the Long Beach Symphony in principal. And that was, I owe that all to that experience at going to Joe's seminar. And wow. And it was great. And I think it really helped all my colleagues, because I came back so energized and enthusiastic that they were asking me all kinds of questions about my experience, and I was able to tell them. And I think it helped everybody. I think I was able to bring back some of that information and enthusiasm that I had for it. And it was really, that was a good time. And that's when I think when I won that job with Long Beach, which, you know, is a small orchestra, but in the local area, that was,
yeah.
So it was kind of a good little, again, I didn't plan this, but it was a nice little boost in my brand, or whatever you want to call it. I don't know, but it helped create a little buzz for me that I didn't, you know, again, I just wanted to play. I didn't care about when, I didn't care that much about winning that job. I just wanted to get in there and play well. And it turned out great. So that really was a really nice experience. So that, and then after that, it's just been, you know, I've subbed a little bit with the Phil, which is always fun. And I did a tour with the LA Chamber Orchestra back in 2008 to Europe for a couple of weeks, which was awesome. And I only played on Pulcinella. That was the only piece with trombone. So I became the restaurant and bar hang representative to find the hang after the gig. So I'd play on the first half, and then I'd split, and I'd go looking around. We're in Paris or in some little town in Italy. And so I always had to find where the hang was going to be after the gig.
You were the scout, right?
Yeah. And I also, my other job was to take pictures of everybody in the orchestra on these beautiful stages, you know, in these beautiful old 17th century opera houses and stuff. So I'd go in the back and take pictures of the orchestra and take pictures of everybody so they could send them back to their families and stuff. So that was fun. You gotta, as a trombone player, you always have to find your alternative purpose. You know, it might be some people. It's fixing a diesel engine. That's the way a lot of trombone players do.
Mechanical greasy thing. Where we're going to get into with that? Because
that's not me. Yeah.
Triggers and rotors and all that stuff. We don't know what we can't do that. That's fast and trumpet players big, right? So you know, speaking of all the equipment and the different styles that you play, what equipment do you normally bring to a session? Because you don't know what you're going to play, and you do play bass trombone great also.
Yeah, I have to do a lot of that. Yeah.
What's the load like for you coming in? Mutes?
Yeah, it's not quite as bad as it's not quite as many as some of the trumpet players I work with. They might bring eight trumpets, but generally speaking, if it's something I don't know what I'm going to do, if I have no idea what kind of music it is, and we, you know, especially if I'm playing first trombone, I bring at least three instruments. I bring my small tenor, large tenor, and a bass. That's sort of standard. There are days when I might have to throw in a euphonium or a bass trumpet and occasionally tuba. You know, that comes into play a little bit for me every once in a while. But mostly it's 90% of the movies is large tenor and bass. But a lot of movies, it's sure nice to have the small tenor there. If they write some stuff, they might have one cue that's pop oriented. It's really nice to have the little zippier sound as an option. But that's, I play this trombone I have here is a Greenho trombone, which I'm an endorsee for them. I love these instruments. This my favorite tenor trombone I think I've ever played is this Greenho. It's great horn. And probably my favorite bass trombone I've ever played is the Greenho bass trombone that I play, which was kind of at the time was kind of a custom model that they were developing with Bill Reichenbach. And that was one of his throwaways. That was one of the rejects, and he was going to send it back. And I went, ooh, 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 ooh. So I got one of his rejects, and it's a great horn. And that's one of the easiest trombone bass trombones to play. All my tenor trombone player friends pick up that horn and go, God, I'd play bass trombone if I had this horn. You know, it's great. And then I play a little alto, especially now with the orchestra. I play some alto. It's come up a couple times in the studios. A couple of the orchestrators have experimented with it, but we don't see it that often. I kind of like it. I love playing alto. It's a lot of fun. I'm not a virtuoso alto player, but I like it as an option. I like playing it on some of the orchestral repertoire, and especially stuff with choir and Mozart Requiem and all that stuff. But that's kind of my setup. My small tenor is made by Schilke, actually. They've been making trombones, and a lot of people don't realize that they've been, especially the last 5 or 10 years, they've been making some really nice trombones. And my small tenor is a Schilke, and I love it. And they're partnered with Greenho now. And we're in the process right now. I'm working with them I'm working with Greenho, the Greenho folks and Schilke folks on a smaller tenor. They've got some prototypes that I'm due to go back to Chicago to try of some small tenors that are going to have the Greenho name, which I'm excited about that. So I could possibly be playing all Greenho horns, which is awesome. I've never been with an instrument company where I played the same brand of all the instruments. It's kind of neat. So anyway, that's exciting. That's hopefully when things calm down, I'll be able to fly back to Chicago, and they tell me they have bells and slides and all kind of, I'm just chomping at the bit to go try them. I'm not a big equipment person. I tend to stick with what I have. And always seem to come back pretty much to what I've had before. If I do, I sometimes go off the road a little while and I go back to where I was. And my setup, I use Schilke mouthpieces on most of my horns. I play an old Bach 6 3/4 C, which is kind of a fairly medium large tenor mouthpiece on my small tenor. And then I use I've been using either a Schilke or a Lasky bass trombone mouthpiece, which is like sort of, I guess, in the 1G size. It's pretty big. I tend to like big mouthpieces on bass trombone. That's just, it's weird. I don't know why, but I feel more comfortable on a little bit bigger mouthpiece on that horn. So that's it. Yeah, we did the mouthpiece thing.
That's right.
Offered it up.
I wanted to ask, I mean, we kind of talked about this a little bit with Wayne, but can you talk about maybe some of the highlights in your studio career, like some things where there's got to be some moments where you've played for somebody or with somebody where you're pinching yourself that you're...
Oh, totally. I've played on all the last three Star Wars movies with John Williams. Well, so that the fact that that score was recorded here was kind of miraculous. And another one of those, how did this happen? Because they'd done all those beautiful scores in London, all those first six movies, and they were so great. And it's like, why would they ever want to come do it anywhere else? I mean, it was so good. Well, because of some health-related things with John, his back, he's been having back problems. You know, he's getting up there. And so he was having some back problems. And so he didn't want to fly back and forth a bunch of times. And he didn't want to fly out there and record for 2 weeks straight on the podium. So he wanted to space out the sessions in a comfortable way that he could just be driven there, do his thing, and then sit down. And the best way he could do that was to record here. So he decided that he wanted to record the score in LA. And so they decided to form a little bit of a new orchestra in a way. There was a lot of familiar people, but they kind of combined some new people together. And it was such a thrill to get to do that. The first time I ever played with John Williams, I was subbing on second trombone for one session. It was a single session. And it was for the movie The War Horse. It was a pretty cool score. The movie is good too, actually. And the score is great because it's almost like a flute concerto for his first flute player at the time, Luis de Tullio. And it's all this pastoral Irish kind of music. And it's gorgeous. And Luis, it sounds so good. And I think that was one of her last scores she did before she moved away and retired. But she sounds so good on that movie. Anyway, so I came in and I just subbed one day. And they were doing something that they recorded earlier. So the whole orchestra knew this this cue pretty well. But I was sight reading it. And so I turned to Bill Booth, who's another one of my all-time heroes, who plays first trombone for John Williams. And I turned to Bill and I said, "So what's going on with this tune?" And he said, "Well, you know, there's this little slow up here. And then there's this section's a little tricky. And we don't always record with click with John Williams, so you have to watch. You got to watch the old man. So so it's a little different experience when you're recording that way with, you know, a live. It's like a live concert, really. And so so he's just explaining a couple things. And okay, great. All right. So we get in there and they turn the lights down. We have our music stand lights and the movie's going and we're going and I'm playing with John Williams and I'm freaking out. Right. So then the trombones have a couple things to play. I'm just thrilled. And very often in these these situations, they're filming a lot. They'll have an archival video made, and you know, it's in house. Disney does that a lot too. They videotape the sessions. And so I've sensed somebody to my right. I'm on the end. So I'm sensing someone to my right filming, and I'm going, oh, okay. So that's just okay. Add one more little layer of pressure. And you know, I wonder if this guy's got his camera. I mean, great. So I'm playing through the cue, nice trombone licks. It all goes fine. So we do the first take. You know, you're going to have to do it five more times. But the first time I survived, I was happy. And I just sort of took a breath that now I know what the piece is about. And I turned to my right and holding a home video recorder is Steven Spielberg. So again, apparently he does this every film when he works with John. He has so much fun. He has so much fun at the sessions. He's always recording the sessions. And I don't know what he does. I think he has like home movie night with his friends. He invites them over and he shows these things. Oh, look what this score we did. And he's like a little kid. And I turn to him and he looks at me and he makes eye contact and he sort of smiles. And I said, "This is my first day." And he goes, "Hey, you did pretty well." And I said, "Thank you." It was like this funny little exchange I had. It was just all this stuff happening at once. It was so surreal. And it was great. And he's a musician, Steven Spielberg. He actually plays the clarinet quite well. He's pretty good. And so he's totally into the musician. So if you engage with him on that level, he's totally into talking to you. You know, it's not like you're some person on the street who's going to walk up to Steven Spielberg and ask for an autograph. He loves musicians, so he loves talking to people in the orchestra. So it was an amazing experience. It's just one of those things. But that's
with Wayne, he had the same experience when they just did the West Side Story, but he told Spielberg he was making him nervous. What do you know about filming a shot? Hey, by the way, here's somebody from your past. Just wanted to say hello.
Oh, there he is. Hey, Michael.
Hey.
How you doing?
How you doing, bro?
Good to see all these trumpet players. All my nemesis is Wayne and you. Oh, my gosh. This is great.
Carol and John Lewis are watching also, Alex, just so you know.
Who's that? I'm sorry?
No, and John Lewis is watching. And
oh, okay. Carol, John. So, that, I would say all the trumpet players you mentioned, including Jerry and Larry and all those guys, I would say, and I think my trombone player colleagues would attest, all you guys count as honorary trombone players. you know? They're like the good guys, you know? That's not like those other trumpet players that can be a little, you know, not treat the trombone players with respect. You guys hang with trombone players. You're okay. So that Mike, and I think Mark now, he's had enough trombone players on his show. I think he's okay too. I almost turned him down, Mike.
I don't know about that.
I almost turned him down, Mike, when he asked me about this. I said, "You're friends with Sax? Oh, forget it."
I think riffraff was the term you used.
Yeah, it was Wayne that kind of you know, it balanced it out. You know? Yeah.
How are you, Mike? How's
man,
it going out there,
you, bro?
How's your family?
Yeah, everybody's fine, man. We got our couple shots and
good.
Just kind of riding it out.
Great. And you guys are, I was asking Mark earlier, have you guys done any performing live yet, or are you just doing streaming, or?
You know, the orchestra's been doing some streaming, and the way it's going is that it's only been strings, piano, and percussion. Only
okay.
People who can wear masks.
Yeah.
So, you know, unfortunately no winds or brass, but I guess July 1st we're going to be back, so.
Good.
You know, that's the plan.
What, in what capacity?
Right now they're talking about full capacity, but it just depends on the state and, you know, how much they let. But, you know, depending, I mean, we may do like some, you know, diminished forces, you know, maybe we'll do stuff for like 60, 70 players, maybe.
Okay.
Like that.
What about some brass concerts too? That with you guys, that'd be awesome.
That'd be nice. I mean, at this point, you know, we're just talking about full orchestra concerts.
Okay.
You know, fingers crossed, we can just get, you know, 50 people on stage to do some Mozart, I'll be thrilled.
Yeah, well, that'd be good. I mean, it's so nice to see you, Mike. It's such a pleasure. You always bring back so many great memories of us growing up in Southern California.
Well, you know, I don't know if you got into this already with Mark, but I mean, first of all, we both knew each other when we had hair.
That's right.
You know, the main thing. You know, you had a big mop of hair. I had a giant fro, and
it was quite a thing to see.
Oh yeah. It was 1978 when we first met. So that's right. Everybody looked like that. at least that's what I keep telling myself. You did too. Hey, I don't know if you mentioned this to Mark. One of the funniest things when you showed where your house used to be in Arcadia.
Oh yeah.
I guess they built a McMansion and they were selling it.
Yeah.
But your pool was still there.
Still there. Same pool.
Yeah.
It was
yeah.
the biggest, I mean, it was a big pool in comparative, you know, to my friend's pools. It was just a block pool. And, but you know, I grew up in the house originally was about a 1,500 square foot house, you know, a little Southern California cottage put up after the war. Yeah. And it was, they converted the garage into a den, and my parents' bedroom, the master, used to be a patio, and they just filled that in. So it was and it was all done terrible, like not to code. It was kind of a rickety house in a lot of ways. It was a little funky, and you know, I grew up in it. I didn't think anything of it. It was a three bedroom little, maybe by the time they did all the changes, 1,700 square foot house, and then they put in this 8,000 square foot house in the property, and they made all this big video of it, and they were trying to sell it for like $5-6 million, and they couldn't get it. So they ended up auctioning. I think they auctioned it off to a guy who wanted to flip it for $4 million, and he couldn't sell it to make any money. It was like this disaster. It was really fun. And it's not in the most exclusive part of Arcadia. It was right near the high school. It's kind of in between two major streets. It's like, what are they thinking? Yeah, it was pretty amazing. And it looks like, it's hard to say exactly. It looks like something they would use in one of those reality shows, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, it's horrible. Or a movie with those kinds of movies they make that don't have much plot. You know what I'm saying?
man, your pop would have loved that. Your pop would have loved that, man.
Yeah, he saw the house get leveled. Yeah, he saw it get leveled. He saw it get leveled, and we knew there was, because the writing was on the wall. It was going to be made into something pretty unbelievable. But yeah, he was not surprised.
Your pop was a character, man.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, he's a great guy.
I remember him really well. But
yeah,
no, I just want to say, man, it's just, you know, for those guys out there that know you're playing, and you know all the incredible stuff you've done. You always played like that, man. I mean, from the first time I heard you play, it was just like, whoa.
That's nice you said.
What is that? You know, I mean, it's like you're here. It's like, okay, I gotta up my game. And then, you know, we played in a quintet together, UCLA, for, you know, all four. Well, the best part of that quintet is none of us were music majors.
That's right. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Go ahead.
And then Tommy was coaching us. Tommy Johnson.
Yeah, Tommy Johnson was coaching us. Great. I mean, I didn't know my ass from my elbow, so it's just like this super nice tuba guy is like helping us out, you know.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I got to know, you know, over time, like who he was and what he did, and just was in complete awe of him.
Oh yeah, he was amazing. Tommy was pretty amazing, and the party they threw for him, the memorial, at USC, unbelievable. 100 euphonium tuba ensemble. Pros, all pros, and we played Chike 4. I was doing this. I sit next to Lauren Marsteller, who was actually playing all the notes. I'm going, Lauren, you play really loud. I'm going to tuck in.
Like every beat or so, you know.
Yeah, and then all the people that came and spoke and talked about Tommy. I mean, it's amazing what a legacy he left behind as a teacher.
No, he was such a sweetheart. Incredible. I mean, you know, just I remember, you know, working with him with a quintet, and again, man, I didn't know my ass from my elbow, but he was always so nice to us.
You were great in college. I mean, that whole time in college when you were playing so great, and you were so torn with what you wanted to be. I knew it. I mean, you were conflicted and you were fighting it. And then when you told me that day that you were going to go back east, you just said, I'm going to go. I'm going to do this. And I went, yes, do that.
Well, you were always kind of a bellwether for me, man. I mean, you were always kind of that standard. And, you know, and getting to play in the quintet with you and Mike Plumlee. You know, I mean, it just, you guys were kind of this buoy for me as I was kind of, Not quite sure where I was going with it, but man, you always sounded great and were just always incredibly inspiring and incredibly enthusiastic, Mike. And just in every way, man. And just,
you're saying just, I'm a BS artist, and you're affirming that, but
exactly.
So I faked you out really well.
No, man.
That's
man,
very sweet of you. I should just say thank you.
No, man. Seriously, I mean, a nicer dude you'll never find than you in this business. And then to have you up at Steamboat a couple years ago.
That was so
fun.
Getting to
hang with the Boston Brass guys.
And I feel like I have a lifelong friendship with those guys now. I love those guys. It's just a wonderful group. And I feel so privileged that I got to meet Sam. That made a huge impact on me. He was so sweet, and I feel so lucky to have been able to experience him in that context. And he sounded so great up there too. He had the big solo in Old Man River and stuff. I remember that. It was so beautiful.
Guys, we did a, you know, like a ragtime show, and you know, kind of, you know, some dance music.
Authentic, like. It was sort of like a Paul Whiteman band, and it was run like an original 30s kind of radio show that might have actually happened. And then we had that incredible pianist. What was her name? That did the. And played Rhapsody in Blue.
You played the Gershwin show. Why am I spacing on that?
You did the
ragtime show.
Yeah.
No, you did the Gershwin show.
We did both. I did a ragtime show. I did. Oh, we did rags in the show.
Okay.
Yeah. What yeah.
Sorry.
That's okay. Don't worry about it.
Too many loud high notes in my life. Not as many as Wayne, but.
Alex, I have a question. Do you still have your UCLA ID?
No, I don't. But Mike has his. He still has his, I bet.
Yeah, I got mine upstairs somewhere, man.
Yeah, I got. There are pictures of me. I have some pictures somewhere of me at that age. Yeah, at 18 or 19.
I got a couple pictures of us playing in the quintet that I posted a couple times.
Oh, okay.
On Facebook.
Oh, yeah.
Got us outside of Ackerman playing.
The
times we were playing out there.
Oh, yeah. And we played down on Bruin Walk, too, out in front of Kirchhoff. Yeah, it was good. It was fun. That's the first time I ever remember. That was the first time I played all that stuff that you play all the time. You know, both
same
stuff. Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing. Yeah, I think of all those experiences. You don't realize at the time how important that stuff is. Later in life, I mean, it really carries with you your whole life, and nobody says that as it's happening, you know. I mean, I just think of, you know, all that stuff.
I mean, we're so lucky to grow up. I mean, in Arcadia, you had, I mean, your high school had an incredible music program in Santa Monica.
Still do.
You know, it's the same thing. Still do. Yeah. I mean, we're really, really lucky that we had that, and then all the guys who were at SC and Northridge at that time, and CalArts, and You know, the guys in the studios. I mean, there was just such a wealth. It still is. I mean,
yeah.
You and Wayne and, you know, Arturo and John Lewis and, you know, all the, you know, Rob
yeah,
Schneider, you know, Dave Washburn, all these guys. I mean,
yeah,
you know, I'm knocking off all the trumpet players.
Yeah, that's okay. No, it goes. The list goes on. I mean, it's amazing.
Guys, man.
Yeah, yeah, and there's some newer players too, like Rob Scheer is a great, great.
Yeah, I remember Dan Rosenboom.
They're doing it. Yeah, totally inspiring and so fun to play with all these people. I mean, I feel very privileged to live in a freelance community with the kind of players we have and. And new ones coming in all the time too. It's really great. And I love following players in other places. That's that we did this little project. It was a moderate sized project for me, but I ended up delegating really well to some people who did an amazing job with this project we did with some trombonists from London and some trombonists from LA. And we called ourselves Trombones United, just like Manchester United, Trombones United. And they had 15 trombone players. We had 15 trombone players. And we recorded this thing that was like a film noir and then a chase scene between the British guys and us. And Carol Jarvis was instrumental in organizing it too. She did all the video editing, and it's incredible. And one of the Chris Staves, who's a wonderful trombonist in London, is also a top call engineer. He works at Air and does movies and stuff as a mixer. He mixed the thing, and it was just unbelievable. So a really great, that was early on, and fairly early on in COVID we got it together, and we finally put it out I think last May or something. But that was fun, and it was really fun to have a collaboration across the continents, you know. That was really, it was really neat. And you know, there were a lot of them were the studio players that work on the movies in England.
Yeah.
and the players, and it's just so fun to hear everybody at once.
How much do you guys ever get to interact with those guys?
We don't.
You're just in your bubble here.
We're in our bubbles. Yeah. I mean, they're busy.
Kind of do your thing.
Yeah. I mean, we're all busy freelance players. I mean, the players I know, the one of the top call tenor trombone players over there is a wonderful player named Andy Wood, and he's a great all around player. But he's a beautiful jazz player. He knows the tradition. He's very aware of, like, you know, I mentioned Dick Nash earlier. He's a beautiful ballad player.
Yeah.
He has that kind of sound and plays great bass trombone. There's a bunch of them over there like that. They sound great. It's like Lewis, the trumpet player over there. There's some dynamite players to be inspired by.
I know Wayne and Louis are good friends.
Yeah, they've collaborated a few times on some stuff.
I haven't met him yet, but man, he's a sensational player. Jesus.
Great. And a studio whiz,
nice dude too.
Super nice guy, and a complete whiz with all the studio tech. You know, he's really getting that together too. And that's kind of what it's taking now for the next generation of players. I think is you have to have more hyphens after your name if you want to do a freelance thing that way. You got to be able to play. You got to be able to play different types of music comfortably, or at least be able to know when to say no. And then you have to be able to be able to write the chart. You got to be able to record it. You got to be able to mix it. You better be able to make a good video of it. I mean, it's a huge multi-layered thing now to have your own life as a career as a musician. It's involving so many more skill sets than ever, you know.
Mark probably already asked you this, so I apologize if you already treaded this water. But, I mean, how much of this stuff now are you doing just like in a home studio, like what Wayne does, or
sure,
a lot of times you'll get some tracks sent your way and they'll say, we want this and this and this, or
yeah,
you know, solo and give us three options or something.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, we talked a little bit about with Wayne. Wayne was the one who actually got me going on this.
Yeah.
Because I was a Pro Tool complete Luddite, and so I had to sort of get up and running on that real fast. And Wayne even loaned me microphones, and you know, and he made little videos of how to send a file, you know, like once you record, you got to do this, you know, and so it was like real basic stuff. And but now, you know, I have great ribbon mics, and I have a new mic pre, and you know, I'm ready to roll now. So it's pretty good. I can get a pretty good sound out of my little home setup. But it took some work. There've been a couple of the TV shows that have either used several or one of us to record the parts, I do the low brass parts for American Dad, which is fun. And then we work on a cartoon together. Wayne and I do, when each of us do a part. So Alan Kaplan plays first trombone on that. He'll do the first trombone parts, and then I do my second trombone part to him. So it's a little better than just, you know, throwing it in there and hoping it works. So I actually play with him, you know, and I can record it. It's a little more satisfying. But, you know, there's a few handful of TV shows that I think have been out that will probably continue doing this to some extent.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you if this is something you see like going forward. Like, you see,
I probably will.
Like some is going to be a hybrid. Like, some you're going to do in person, some, you know, because they can control it from the board.
It had been heading that way. It had been heading that way for a while. I'm sorry. It had been heading that way for a while with the business. I think there was always, and especially for demos and stuff, that composers might say, you know, I want to hear the trombones on this. Can you just put some parts down so I can hear it? Yeah. So that I can now do that a little bit. And there's, you know, and but as far as doing the real recording work, you know, I still think that there's nothing beats being in a room together. And I think that enough people still feel that way. Not just the musicians, but the people producing the movies, the directors, they hear the difference in the orchestra when it's done in home studios, 60 people with 60 rooms going into one mix. It's a disaster. It's a nightmare to try and make that work. It changes the way the composers write. You know, they can't write the way they really want to, because they know that the music's being recorded in this kind of weird profiled way. So when they actually have the music in one big room reverberating like Sony in one of those rooms, it's so different. It has such a different kind of emotional quality to it that I still think that, but like you say, I there have already been some home recording events happening, so I think it's just going to continue. Hey, there's John Lewis.
Hey,
man.
Hey, Alex,
how you doing, John? Another honorary trombone player.
Yeah, well, what can you say?
That's great.
Hey, I'm John, great to see you, man.
Likewise.
I've been so lucky to have people like John or Wayne playing in my ear these last few years, that if I have any hearing loss, I'm actually grateful on one level that it happened. At least it happened with you guys. Yeah, I mean, this guy John, man, I'm telling you, he is a monster. He's like born for this kind of stuff that we get to record. It just makes it so easy. When I play it, I play a note and I just go, oh man. And if it's not like the most delicious sound in the world, I know I'm wrong.
I'll tell you, it's a lot of magic that's going on, and it's just been really amazing. And sitting behind you and being able to blow your hair off. Oh wait, too late.
Yeah. Hey, John, I was wondering, John and Mike, have you guys ever played together?
We did, actually. We did a couple of children's, right before you left. I mean, we played a couple of Pasadena Boys Choir concerts. Remember that,
yeah.
Mike?
Yeah. Now that I think about it, yeah.
And Mike was talking about, yeah, this freelance thing, man, this is really tough. And he's having, and then bang.
Bang, yeah.
Out of funny. Town and stardom beyond belief. So
yeah, that's funny, huh? That's great. Well, Mike, it's amazing. Hey, that's, you know, I've known a couple people. I think of like Alan Bear is another one who was,
yeah,
here, and then it, like, he left and he just took off. He sprouted his wings, you know. It's like this whole thing happened. It's so exciting to be like where you started, that where that process started, and then you see this person taking off later. It's so exciting. It's really inspiring. And let me ask you, Mike, I'm curious about this, because you were always a great player. And when we were at college, even back in high school, when we played in honor bands and stuff, and in college, you were a great player. Awesome. But I know that you were frustrated in a lot of ways with your playing, and there were things about it that you got focused and you decided to go back to school and really focus on it. And I remember we had that conversation about that. When was it in your recollection, along that time from then till now, when did you start to, did you ever make this recognition that things were clicking? Like, was it an audition response, or was there something that happened along the way where you go, hey, I think this is happening. I can actually make it work.
I mean, I'm sure similar to you and John and Mark. I mean, you know, there's just certain moments in your life where all of a sudden, like as a light bulb moment, it's like, oh, that's what it's supposed to sound like. That's what it's supposed to feel like.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, there were a few different ones. I mean, that one was a summer when I was actually, I was at Empire Brass Quintet Symposium, and Palathian was coaching my group when I was 19. That was kind of an aha moment. It's also when I met Mark Gould, which was a big kind of seminal moment. And then when I was studying with Tony Plogue, and he started doing more composition, a little less teaching, and then he connected me with James Stamp.
Oh, okay.
So connecting with Mr. Stamp was a huge, like, genesis moment for me.
Okay.
In my playing. Interesting. And then, you know, just a few concerts, like a summer at Aspen, there was a concert there. Yep. And then later on when I was in New York, there was a concert when I played Zarathustra, where it just, it kind of just certain things clicked, or certain things happened that were like, oh man, I think I can do this.
Yeah. What about you, John? You know, because I, you've had such an interesting. When you came to LA, your LA life was so interesting. With, I mean, you got to understand about John. He's a hard worker, and he came to town willing to do what he needed to do to make a living. We were delivering papers for a while, right?
Four years, yeah.
Yeah, he was up at 5 a.m. What, you got to get like 4 a.m. or something?
4:30 4:30 to 6:30 Yeah.
Oh, this is a guy with a work ethic. Okay, so that's interesting there. But I, like when you were in Kansas, right? I mean, what were the sorts of things that you would say? Was it like Mike, where you had like maybe there was a concert where you go, okay, this is, I'm kind of getting a hang of this.
You know, I think kind of like Mike, that when I was at KU, I played. I mean, I literally had the metal to flesh about 10 hours a day. But my goal was just to go back to Washington and be in the Army band, which my teacher had done. And then I...
Oh. Ah! No, it was really good! You broke up, John! It's that North Carolina connection.
Oh,
it was so good!
Oh, man.
So good!
That looks like a really important point he's about
to make. Look at that! It's so intense! I'll text him.
I bet he comes back on in just a second.
Hang on just one sec.
Yeah. He looks so serious.
I'll be back in one sec.
Okay.
Yeah. You can edit all this out, right?
Yeah. I can edit this part out. And anybody who's, and this is a good time for me, is anybody who's watching, I'm apologizing about captions. Oh, he'll come back.
He'll come back, yeah.
You know, and I was going to say, while he was on there, it was interesting to see all of you guys in one space because of the John Williams connection, because, of course, Michael premiered the John Williams concerto, exactly. And then John Lewis, of course, with the Star Wars movies.
Yeah.
So maybe Alex, if you could kind of talk about that, like, because you're on the new Star Wars movies, we were just starting to talk about that. I mean,
you know, John will corroborate with this. I mean, we're so lucky. We play with all these really interesting, different styles. They're all over the map stylistically, these composers. Some of them have no orchestral experience at all, and they have to have they have orchestrators that help make it work. And their scores are great, even though they're not as studied, perhaps, but they fit the movie. I've been so wrong a few times when I was first starting out doing studio work. We'd be playing a score and we go, God, this is a little unsatisfying. And you go to the movie and it's perfect for the movie. So like a film composer has to understand film as much as they understand music, maybe even more. Honestly, they have to really understand the film. So, but when you work with John Williams, though, I mean, John, you can back me up on this. I was just talking about John Williams. When you work with John Williams, it's like it's all there. All the boxes are ticked. He understands film. He understands art. He understands music on such a deep level compared to most musicians you encounter in any idiom. And the way he will introduce a theme, like in a movie, if you watch Star Wars, he's hinting at the big melody that he's going to have finally come to shape. Like he'll have one note of it, or he'll have some juxtaposition of the note in retrograde or whatever. He'll do all these tricks, and then finally it'll be ba dee da 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 da. You hear it. When you finally hear it, it's a familiar tune. He's been psyching you into this thing for maybe an hour, and it's spectacular, that level of understanding of the story that he brings to the music. That's the thing that always gets me. And when we were recording those, the first time we played those Kylo Ren theme, that, you know, that big scary theme for Kylo Ren, it was like, holy cow. And we knew when we played it that we're going to have to play it a lot, because that's what we do with, you know, in those scores with him, is he gets a theme and he brings it back every once in a while during the movie. And, you know, that style of writing has sort of fallen out of favor with certain directors, because they don't want the John Williams thing. It's like they actively want they feel like in some directors feel that that is something that maybe dates their film or makes it fall into a certain category, and they don't want their film to be that, which I, you know, I kind of understand that. But then when you hear it actually done as well as John Williams does it, it's like there's nothing like it. It's such a powerful experience to hear it either in the theater or playing it in the orchestra. The thing that impressed me about the playing in the orchestra the first couple times is how much softer we played than I thought we were gonna. That, wouldn't you say, John?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
You just go for that controlled, balanced, resonant sound, and it comes, and you have Sean Murphy engineering, you have John making sure the orchestra is balanced before we start recording. He rehearses this like a real orchestra. And so you never feel like you have to pump really hard. You walk out of there refreshed. It's like, and everything's in tune. The players are all awesome. And you come out of that experience and you go, wow. And you hear the movie and there's plenty of sound there that you know, it doesn't feel like, you know, you never feel like people are sloughing it off or underplaying. But I don't know how they do it in England, if they approach it the same way. But I know that was one of the first things Bill Booth told me when I sat down. I said, is there anything we should talk about? He's all, knock one dynamic down on just about everything until they ask for more. And it was like, great, done. That was it. And it was so nice to play that way. Everybody's getting their best sound, you know, that way.
You know, I'm sorry, I'm in North Carolina. I don't know. Internet's not as good in North Carolina right now. So I got bumped out here. But, you know, when we do the John Williams stuff, and I just want to talk about, I know this is Alex's show. So I really just want to say that, you know, as Alex said, when you do John Williams, it takes it to three levels higher. All of a sudden, it's like the old commercials when E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens. And when John, no matter what he says, you listen, because it's profound and it's quite an experience. Everybody brings their A game. But I want to talk about Alex for a second, because we just finished doing Space Jam 2, which the first one we did in 1995. And I was the one that recognized it. I was the only guy. I was a young kid back then, and I was the only guy that had done it in 95. And Alex was playing principal trombone, and, you know, with COVID, we're all spread apart and we're walls and everything. And I got to tell you, Alex, you're the bomb, man.
Thank you.
You lead the section. They got big sections where partitions, and I watched the trombones. I watched Alex. You know, they figured out we have these baffles between us. They figured out if you back up just a little bit so your head's behind the baffles, you can hear each other. And it really made all the difference in the world.
That helped a lot, as it turned out. It was amazing how if you don't hear each other, you're not going to play together. It's a simple thing. But we cheated. We had to cheat.
It's like playing by Braille. You know, you can't hear anybody else in your section. Yeah. And you can't hear, all you can hear is what's coming in the phones, which is nothing. And
yeah. And the challenge too is, like, even if you try to go with the click, it never works out. I mean, we noticed that the first few times we were recording remotely, you play with people that when you're all in a room together, you play with the click and you're all perfectly in agreement. But as soon as we are in our separate homes and we're each playing with the click, it's totally apart. There's no way we could play it together. I mean, it's amazing. We really do rely on each other, even just to play with click. We have to rely. Yeah. We have to listen to each other. It was really interesting. But thanks for saying that, John. I mean, you should. Oh, this movie, when this comes out, the trumpet playing in this thing is spectacular. And Chris, the composer, Chris.
Don't ask me.
He does. Bridget. He did Bridgerton too. That'll come to me. Oh, terrible old man's disease.
I'm gonna look it up.
Look it up for me while I'm. I'll tap in.
Chris Carter?
Chris.
Was it Chris Carter?
No. Chris. Anyway, you can look it up, Mark.
I'll look it up.
Okay. But he's a real deal. He's a Juilliard composition guy. He really knows his stuff. And he was not making it easy for us. He knew how to make us really work our butts off for this music. And I think the score is going to come off pretty good, despite all the Pepe Le Pew controversy over that. I don't know if you heard about that. They cut Pepe Le Pew out because it was, some people found it a little offensive, which I understand. You know, it's what it is. But the music is great. Would you figure it out, John?
Chris Bowers.
Bowers. Yeah. Bowers. Yeah. Yeah. He's
I don't want to step on your toes here. I just want to say hello, and I love you. And
thank you for coming in. I mean,
yeah, John. It's late back there. You should be going to bed, old man.
Well, Alex, I'll see you next week and or somewhere around there. And absolutely. Great seeing you guys.
Hey, John, great to see you.
John, I'll have you on always. Here pretty soon, I promise.
I'd love that.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, great. Safe travels. See you soon, John.
All right, guys.
Bye-bye. Yeah, he's what a great first trumpet player.
He's terrific. Man,
that stuff. And he had to go the full gamut. He had these insanely delicate high things to play, and then some just real gutsy aggressive kind of stuff that was kind of like Wayne stuff in a way. It was like getting into that world, and he was fine with it. It was like not a peep of complaint or anything. I was like, yeah, he's amazing.
No, it's first class. I mean, yeah, he's a great, great musician.
He replaced you in my brass quintet, Mike.
Hey, we have honored, man.
I would love to hear you guys together.
At some point, I was just thinking, man, if I can only turn back the clock to when we were 21, we're all in the same place, man.
Yeah,
you know,
I would love to hear you guys.
Actually, I'd gone to the proctologist by then and got my head out of my ass. So, be able to know. No, but thinking back, because I had forgotten about that. Yeah, John and I played some choral thing in Pasadena. Tony Plug got me that job.
Yeah, Tony Plug. Wow, that is another person who's just a huge influence, right? I have all his books. I have all 7 volumes of his books. They're great. I love those. He and Bill Booth, who I mentioned earlier, who plays first trombone with John Williams. Great, great player. Big influence. I studied with him for a little while, too. He's great. He and Tony have had a really good friendship for years, and Tony wrote some nice trombone things for Bill that are dynamite. Yeah, it's so nice when you come across a brass player who actually knows how to compose. It's like we mentioned Brad Edwards earlier. He's that way. He's a great composer and knows how to write for trombone because he's such a good trombonist. Yeah, it's neat. It's pretty cool.
Listen, I hate to do this, and you're going to laugh, but we live on West Coast time, and I got called for dinner about 10 minutes ago, so I'm probably meat if I don't get upstairs pretty soon. But no, she understands. Yolanda knew I was going to, be talking, hanging with Mark and with you. And,
yeah, give her my love. I still need to meet Yolanda in person. I feel like I know her, but anyway, tell her hello.
Mike, Jerry Hay just said hi, by the way. I just wanted to make sure.
He's still here? Jerry? Well, he's been hanging here this whole time. Jerry's amazing. Has he got absolutely nothing to do?
No, and again, man, another one of my just all-time heroes.
Oh yeah,
just somebody who I adore and a wonderful guy. I mean, all those guys, Larry, Jerry, Gary, all those guys are just the best.
Just the
I mean, just
musical voice of a generation. Those guys.
The best.
Gary said he ate dinner.
All right, I'm going to go eat dinner.
Yeah, go eat dinner.
Jerry is correct. All right, Alex, much love, brother.
All right. Likewise, Michael.
Thanks for letting me in, man.
All right. Be well. Man.
Take care, guys.
Thanks, Mike. See you soon.
Take care, John. Take care.
So Alex, you've covered a lot of stuff tonight.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
And it's just awesome. And, and anybody who wants to know more about you should absolutely go to your website. Some great pictures on there. And I noticed one of them, and it made me, it reminded me of the Chris Farley show, because you remember when he did that on SNL? Because I just want to ask you, do you remember when you worked with Paul McCartney?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's
Before you answer that, anybody that doesn't know what I'm talking about, if you go to YouTube and you look up the Chris Farley show, where Chris Farley asked Paul McCartney if he remembers when he was with the Beatles, you'll completely understand that joke I just told.
Now, I often tell my students, don't be upset if you're always the sub. There's times when, they get that phone call and say, "Oh, I'm so glad you can do the gig. We've tried everybody else." And you think, "Oh man, I'm just chopped liver. I'm never going to get, nobody's ever going to call me first." You get it. You turn it to Eeyore. It's easy to have that happen. Well, let me tell you, I would say out of the top 5 experiences I've had musically of fun or interest or excitement, like when I subbed with John Williams the first time, that I was subbing. I was not the first call. And this was another one of those examples. Paul McCartney had just recorded an album of standards, a bunch of old songs that he grew up listening to when he was a kid. And so he wanted to do a live performance of these these songs at Capitol Records with a lot of the people that played on the record, and including Diane Krall and Joe Walsh and all these heavyweight pop music people. And they had used several brass players had played on it from LA, including there was one tune that had a really nice trombone solo on it that Ira Napes, who's a wonderful trombonist from LA, veteran studio and jazz player, one of my favorite tasty jazz players ever. And Ira has been a big influence on me over the years. He's a great guy. And Ira played on the original record. He played a beautiful little cut mute trombone solo on this one. It was an old Fats Waller tune. And as my friend Tom Kubas likes to say, it's an old Fats Waller tune because there are no new Fats Waller tunes. Anyway, it was called My Very Best Friend, the Milkman. And he played this nice little solo. And so the session came up, the video recording came up. Ira, unfortunately, was out of town. He was not available. They decided to add this tune to this video session at the last minute. And they didn't have a trombonist that they had already called. Fortunately, I'd worked with one of the orchestrators on the job. Was it was Chris Waldman, who was a excellent orchestrator and arranger and had written some of the arrangements for this particular session. So Chris suggested calling me the day before the session. So I got a call and they said, come to Capitol tomorrow. You're going to be playing with Paul McCartney. And I went, what? And so they said, we'll send you the recording of the tune that Paul wants to do. So he sent me the recording with Ira's nice solo. So out of just because I wasn't sure how things were going to go, I transcribed Ira's solo in case that Paul was, you know, a lot of artists, they get used to the solo that's on the record. So I just learned his solo and I went in, I was ready to do whatever. And I sat there and I was sitting there and there was a string section there and they were all looking at me like, what are you doing here? And I just played the trombone sitting next to Paul McCartney. And when he walked in, I'd just met Diana Krall, who was a big hero of mine and, you know, a total amazing artist. And I was talking to her we're in a little ante room at Capitol. Jerry knows the room. And so I'm sitting there talking to Diana Krall, and she's very nice and she's a little nervous. You know, she's a very self-conscious person. She's a little uptight and, you know, understandably. And then Paul McCartney walks in the room and the air just gets sucked out. You know, here comes Paul McCartney and he's got three or four people with him and he goes, hello, love. And he greets Diana Krall and he says, hi, I'm Paul. And I go, yeah, I know. And I guess he does this to everybody. You know, so he always just makes it kind of, it's a way to break the ice. And so I said, hi, I'm your trombone player. He's like, oh, great, glad you're here. You know, he's very nice. And he walks away, goes over the piano. And Diana Krall, I just met her. She leans in right against my ear and goes, I don't care how or when it happens, but every time he says anything to me, I turn into a 13-year-old girl. It was just, she was so, she'd been working with him for years now. I mean, she's been collaborating with him on things. And he said, she said she's never gotten over it. It was really funny. But that was a really fun experience. And the people in the production said, hey, you know, you go ahead and play a little bit. If you want to go away from the solo on the record, that's fine. I said, well, okay. So it was a fun little experience. I really had a good time. And yeah, it was really great. John Clayton and let's see who else was playing. Bucky Pizzarelli was playing. John Pizzarelli was playing guitar, and it was just a great grooving little band. And I just got to play a little bit with the rhythm section and Paul McCartney. It was really wild.
Wow.
Yeah, really wild. Yeah. He was very nice.
You've had some incredible experiences. I mean, you know, and that's. You said that's got to be one of the top ones. Is there any? And before we kind of close out of that part of this,
is there anything else? I'll tell you, the first couple of times I worked with Jerry Hay, how about that? Jerry Hay, I was so amazed by this music, you know, for so long. I was we were all in awe of all the stuff he did with Michael Jackson and the Earth, Wind & Fire stuff and all the stuff with Quincy. And it was so such inspiring music as. You know, that was a part of me that was so into Chicago when I was younger. It was like that was the next that was the graduate level of that kind of experience. You know, the next level of taking that whole horn section kind of writing and approach and playing to another level that was so freaky good and makes you think, how can anybody even think they can be a musician when there's people like that doing stuff? And players like, you know, and that's when I got to know the players like Charlie Loper, who was one of my all-time heroes on trombone, and Bill Reichenbach, who's another person. I'm just this freaky kind of musicianship that I just could never imagine even being in the same room as these people. They're so incredible. And Jerry's writing is just so spot on all the time. And so when I got called to do a jingle, and it was just a jingle to me. I didn't know what it was. Or the composer. Well, it turned out it was Jerry was playing first trumpet. And I think he might have written the chart, because I think it was, and whatever was written, because there wasn't much written. And that's the thing that got me, is we walk in and he's calling out the parts you're going to play, and you better hang in there. And if you do anything the least bit off, Jerry's going to say, no, that's a little high there. You know, he would hear it exactly. And it was like, what, that just pushed me up another level of awareness. And also the one time I did a movie, Jerry was in the trumpet section, and I think it might've been for Alan Silvestri. And it was a big orchestra score, and it was a big chase cue. I forget what movie it was for, but we read it down. Everybody sight reading, a lot of notes, a lot of stuff to do. We finished the cue, and as is often the case, I think the conductor might have gone in the booth or the composer, you know, Alan went into the booth to talk to the people in the booth. So we're in the room by ourselves with the orchestra. People are kind of talking. Jerry turns to the oboist, Earl Dummler. I'll never forget this. He says, "Hey Earl, what do you have at bar 37?" And Earl says, "I have an F natural." And Jerry said, "You know, I think it should be an F sharp." Okay, let's look back. We just sight read a piece of music for an 80-piece orchestra. Everybody sight reading, Jerry included. And he had the wherewithal and the awareness to hear an oboe note that was wrong on a one pass on a piece of music that was not necessarily like, it wasn't, we're not talking about, hot cross buns here. It was a pretty harmonically rich thing. And Jerry heard that and I went, wow. So what that did for me, and I think this in general is kind of a theme, I think, for me as a musician here in a great community of musicians, is when you're around people like that are on that level, that is so high, you can only aspire to be somewhat closer to that. You may never get to their level, but it makes you better. It makes you realize, first of all, that it's possible. That's, I think, the most important thing is people hear that. That people actually play this way, people can hear that kind of stuff while they're playing. I mean, that's what I learned from that experience and things like that, you know. And then another thing Jerry did with me, where I was doing one of his dates, might have been Buble or somebody like that, and it was so we were playing one of his parts, and I think it was a pretty big.
Jerry just commented, "The facts are Tom Boyd, and it was an A flat."
Oh, of course he remembers. Okay, so that's very funny. Oh man, that's very funny. So he we were doing this thing. It was like, I think it was six brass, so it was a larger section than his usual brass section. So I think it was myself and maybe Bill, two trombones and two or three trumpets, two saxes, and we had this line. It was pretty technical, kind of a fast line. And I was articulating it. You know, I was kind of articulating it. And Jerry's sitting, might have been sitting behind me. And he said, "You don't tongue any of that." I said, "What?" I said, "It's going to gliss." He's all, "Fine. We're playing a tune. We got buttons. The gliss is, they'll never hear it." I went, "What?" And we, sure enough, we had, like that. And boom, it was fine. We listened to the playback. It sounded like we were nailing it. And I went, "Oh my God, what a great secret." So I'm not telling anybody that secret. Well, now I have told everybody that secret. So for the record, I articulate everything exactly as it's written, just so you know. No. Yeah. But anyway, Jerry gave me a trombone lesson that day. So that was cool. And he used, and a lot of times he was sitting in a section with Chuck Finley, who is a great trombone player. Have you ever talked to Chuck Finley about his trombone playing?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Chuck has been on when we had Jerry's interview, and hopefully we'll get him on again. And
that's great.
Phenomenal.
First time I ever heard him play live, he was playing trombone. I went to a trombone group with a rhythm section, and he was subbing for Frank Rossellino. He was playing trombone. I said, I've got to heard this guy on records. That's the same guy? Is that the trumpet player? And he was killing it. He sounded great. It was amazing. Anyway, he's another one. Chuck Finley's another person that you can't even believe exists till you actually you meet them and hear them play. You know, it's a totally different thing.
Well, and all great guys all the time too. I mean, just super super talented.
So positive and funny and great, and you know, break the tension. If there's ever tension at work, they're the ones that, you know, that make you feel like you know where you're gonna what you know what you need to do to fit into what's there. They lay it down that way. You know, some people might not be able to catch on to it, or be able to produce, but they'll give you they'll show you the way. You know, they give you a big target to point at, and it's so inspiring. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Alex, this has been amazing. I know I've taken your whole night.
Oh,
but
it's my pleasure. You
know, but before we close, I mean, I think that, you know, in doing the research on you and watching some interviews and reading some things, it's just, you're such a positive person. Mm-hmm. And your outlook is just so broad in scope, like you talked about with all the different kinds of music. And I wondered if before we close, because, you know, the pandemic's been really tough on a lot of musicians, both financially, spiritually, mentally, in all those ways. I mean, you know, how is it that, you know, when you think about the way you get through some of these times and how positive you are, I mean, what kind of lessons do you think you might have learned or insights have you gained in this period that might be helpful to somebody?
It's interesting. I think I'm still going to be parsing that out for another year of just seeing what it was that, what kind of process did go on. I would say that my mind has opened up to a lot of new ideas about music that I didn't have before. I think I've been spending quite a bit of time taking advantage of the time to learn new things, in both musically and outside music. And as far as production go, I'm a lot more comfortable than I used to be. I know just enough to cause a lot of damage, as far as my technical know-how. But I feel more comfortable with that, in general. That's one thing. I mean, I think that for me, I don't have much confidence in my abilities as far as technical stuff goes. And for me, this was a huge boost to my confidence to be able to produce a few tracks here at home and be able to work with students through it too. And be able to teach, you know, like they teach you in as medics in the army or in medical school, I guess too, is you do one, you know, you watch one, you do one, you teach one. That's what they do. You know, like any sort of procedure out on the field, you know, you watch somebody, you do it yourself, and then you teach somebody else. And I like that quick learning kind of process. And I think things today that I think you have an opportunity to do that, more so than ever before. I think that it's been especially hard on artists of all kinds right now. I think of my friends who work on Broadway, and all the people that are involved in theater back east and in all over the world. Any live performance kind of people, my heart breaks. You know, the Metropolitan Opera, any of the places like that, even people who are in community theaters, and this is their life. Even if they have a job that they really, you know, they have money, a way to make money, but their involvement, their commitment to these live performance of any kind, whether it's for money or not, it's a huge part of our souls has been just ripped from under us. And I think that as a lot of businesses are getting back to, which is good. And I think it's important that we see a lot of businesses return and get back up and running. A lot of new businesses are emerging, which is good. That's all good. But this thing about creating and sharing art with people has been so decimated by this time. And I really hope that there will be support there for people who maybe are not the high priority kind of arts groups in their area. They might not be the high profile artists, and Hollywood is going to be okay. Broadway eventually will be okay, but it's going to take, you know, but what about off Broadway? What about all those other, and what about the people who just do it for the sheer love of doing it? That's a huge part of our culture and our livelihood as ultimately, you know, I feel like my livelihood is tied into the people that do it for fun too. I really, it's important for them to stay enthusiastic about live music and be able to participate and do it themselves. It's a huge part of the being an American, I think, is embracing your hobbies and the things that you love to do. It's one of the great things about living in this country. And not to get too fine a point on it, but I'm hurting to not see community orchestras and community groups playing. And my heart breaks with all the school groups that are still forced to make do. And I'm so inspired by the music teachers that have been able to keep things going and stay on track and adapt to this. It's an unbelievable thing what I see happening in music education right now. The adaptation that's gone on is inspiring, and they're still teaching music but from a different perspective. And in many ways, some of the kids are learning more about the music that they're going to play when they're back than they would have. They would have just been rehearsing for the next concert for their parents or the big festival. But now they have to actually, you know, they're spending some time learning about the composers. They're learning about the recordings that are out there of these pieces of music. You know, and I think some of the teachers have done a great job of following through on that idea. There's these things are going to be good stories at the end of it, as there are always these inspiring stories after a war or after some other kind of tragedy. That I think there'll be lots of inspiring stories. And plus, the kids that are going through it now this is what they're going to tell their kids about, the way our parents talked about the Depression or talked about whatever other experiences they in war or anything like that that had such an effect on them. You know, I think it's gonna ultimately be a very interesting effect. I have some friends who say, look what happened after the pandemic in 1918. What happened with art and culture in America? It just exploded. You know, we had the jazz age, and we had all the birth of really the dissemination of jazz music. We had Tin Pan Alley took off. You know, radio took off. I mean, we had all this great boom of technology, and it was a great time after that pandemic. So maybe, who knows, maybe we'll have something like that. That'd be nice to see. I'd love to see people go back to concerts and playing for fun in ways that they didn't even think of before. That'd be great. You know, we could be better than we were before. Maybe, I don't know.
That'd be great. That'd be super. Oh. Well, that's a great answer and obviously a positive message too. So Alex, I can't thank you enough for coming on tonight and thanks to all the people that came on. I think we had Michael Sachs, Wayne Bergeron, John Lewis, Jerry Haycon-Manning. Yeah. Not a bad trumpet section.
Holy cow. I'd sit in front of that trumpet section any day.
I'll play fifth trumpet to that trumpet section.
Absolutely. You're in there.
Thanks so much, Alex. And sure. Thanks for watching and stay safe, and we'll see you very soon.
Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.